is red.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Selectmen Special Meeting for Monday, February 11th. It's 7:30. This meeting will be recorded and will be available on the town website in the near future. I would like to begin with a Pledge of Allegiance. Commissioner Brady, would you lead us in the pledge, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So we only have one main item on the agenda, but it is a big one. It is the presentation of the First Selectman's budget for fiscal year 1920. I need to throw in one little fact. Happy birthday, Wendy, and then move on.
Happy birthday.
So when crafting this budget, we sort of stuck with the traditional pattern, tried to hit it as closely as possible, try to maintain town services to the extent possible and reasonable, address infrastructure needs now. We tend to not, as a philosophy, want to put off capital spending for the sake of putting it off because it catches up and usually costs more. Minimize mill rate increase, especially in light of the fairly high level of the reval, which we'll get into a little, which is about 6.75% drop in grand list. And then budget both expenditures and revenues realistically. That is not sort of play games, making unrealistic assumptions, because again, that catches up with us, could put us in a situation where we don't have enough funding to do what we need, etc. So here's the current fiscal year forecast. The good news is that we're doing better than projected, significantly better. And that's very useful, the fact that we have about $1 million buffer in there, because we did have some overruns. They weren't unexpected. This $94,000 particularly was mainly being driven by the hiring of an SRO in the middle school, which, as far as I can tell and everything I've heard, has been a remarkable success. Board of Ed had a few overruns, primarily in the outplacement space. Those usually come in, but again, that number of 147 is a lot friendlier than the year before. Overall, we ran somewhat of an operating loss, but we then made up for it, so we netted out about $514,000 in the green, which is always nice. Our fund balance, despite our attempts to do otherwise, continues to grow. We're up a bit. We're up to $14,298,008, which is a whopping 18.1%. We're still hearing that maybe you need 12-13% at max to AAA rating, but yeah, that's our reference group. So stable balance sheet, we're in pretty good shape. Fund balance, you can see the history again, we keep trending up. One thing I want to mention is that we have talked about the fact that we've been sort of collecting this fund balance for the purpose of sort of special large-scale capital needs. I'd like to say that we moved a large piece of that forward. It got approved by planning and zoning just last Monday night. The police, fire, and EMS basically remodeling upgrade fixes. That was a significant project. And with that, along with our communication needs and a few other fixes, will eat up a good chunk of our reserve fund in the future. So this is where we anticipate going after we sort of take all of that stuff into account. So we're going to actually bring it down, but we're bringing it down knowing that there's a purpose to bring it down, and it still leaves us way above where we need to be for AAA rating. Talk a little bit of our economic data, which is the good news, and I'm glad we're leading with a bunch of good news because the overall budget is not ideal, but it's something we have to work with, and I'll talk about why. Unemployment rate is 3.7%. Can't complain, had it trending down. We started at 0.835, so we're almost back to where we were pre-crisis. Social service clients now there's a little bit of an issue here in terms of whether it's an apple to apples comparison between 17 and 18. We have a new director, thank you, Allison. But she has provided what I believe to be extremely accurate numbers. So, you know, it may be there are numbers that are going down somewhat, or that we're recording it a little better because we did this whole database review and reassessment of the people there. In any event, what we're gonna be benchmarking from the future is off this number. So up and down, we're gonna peg it to this trailing number. We've got, the good news is, again, it's down. We've got 98 total households that are using social services. Of those, 53 of them are doing it for financial need. And we've got, I believe there's a number of children, not number of families with children. Number of children who are using social services down to 35, which is a fantastic number. That number, as you can see, kind of rose up during the Great Recession, and right now it's back down again. Zero should be the number we strive for, but I have a lot of faith in the fact that even if we have these 35, Allison and crew are gonna take amazing care of them. New home construction, not great. We know that. Two reasons for that. One is we almost have no land left. Depending on how you look at it, maybe we have 250 maximally buildable lots, and those are usually pretty challenged pieces of property. And that includes some of these large lots that are now being looked at. One of them, the Nevis property, the Nature Conservancy is looking at acquiring, I think, 70-something of the 99 acres of that, so that's going to take a whole bunch more land off. There just aren't a lot of buildable lots left. There could be teardowns and rebuilds and stuff, but generally we don't have a lot of land. The other thing is economic activity is not generally great. You can see in 07, you know, the numbers were up pretty high, but since then we've kind of trailed along this sort of flat line between 6 and 9, let's say. Interestingly, though, we're seeing a lot of activity in the remodeling space. So that's potentially good news. It's not the same input we're going to have into the grand list, but when people upgrade their houses, we eventually catch up with them. They get folded back into reval, and their home value basically gets reflected in that divisor. So that's good news. That's a very, very strong number. I think it's
surprising. Just wanted to jump in right here. If you could also talk about Dominic, right, with the new building official and wanting more permits as opposed to previous, his predecessor. Would ask for like one permit, and people would do a whole bunch of work under one permit, and Dominic said no, under the law you actually have to apply for several permits for like building a new house or renovation. So that, just wanted to point out, that has also spiked the number.
Right, that has spiked that number up. And the other good news is commensurate with that line going up is fees for different subspecialty remodeling. So that's good news on the revenue front as well. Grand list growth, this is factoring out the effect of the reval, and it's just a number of kind of new houses, and we just saw those numbers are pretty small, and other additions, new cars, all that sort of stuff. Flat. Again, you know, not robust growth by any means, but at least it's not negative. Moving on, state's huge concern. We've been talking for years about this pension issue. There were two shoes. One of them actually hit this year. There's the teacher pensions, and then there's the overall MRF program, which is Municipal Employee Retirement Fund, which is part of the MERS program, Municipal Employee Retirement System. And that shoe hit, and we'll be talking about that because that has a very significant effect on our budget this year and actually out for the next 5 years. And it's real. It came sort of at the last minute, but that was the first shoe to hit in the pension story. So currently, state-wise, estimated $245 million surplus. Tax receipts have been fairly robust, which is good news. This money's all going into the rainy day fund, and a lot of it's sequestered for that purpose. However, we're looking at massive deficits, of course, and we've been hearing that about that all along. And we're talking fiscal year 1920, $1.7 billion. Fiscal year 2021, $2.3 billion deficit projected. And the reason we're talking about that is we do have to make some assumptions when going forward this budget about things that could happen between now and the time we get the governor's budget. So we need to keep some powder dry because anything could really happen. A piece of that teacher's pension can come back in some form or another, or any number of other things can happen. They're talking, they're putting that bill forward that would basically, in lieu of us getting money back and citizens paying for car taxes, there would just be a 1% tax that would go to the state and would be redeployed based on some kind of need formula. You can guess, given Weston's overall wealth level, although I need to point out again and again and again, not everybody in Weston is wealthy. We're talking about a lot of people who need social services. They cannot absorb these impacts. In any event, we need to keep those things in mind when talking about you know, what we're keeping, what powder we're keeping dry. So the overall outlook, we're estimating a 0.6% growth in grand list, 420 in new revenue to help offset you know, mill rate. We'll talk about that a little bit. Maintaining tax collection rate at 98%. We could go more aggressive, but at this time, in terms of some of the discussions we talked about keeping the powder dry, we want to leave it at that number. We have a $50,000 increase in delinquent tax revenue. We've been doing better in collecting. We did have the tax sale. People are aware that, you know, there are some ramifications to continually not paying, and they understand that there's a 18% annual accrual to not paying taxes. $50,000 increase in supplemental auto tax. About 5 years ago, we weren't actually assuming we'd get anything back in the state, and slowly we've been trying to true it up to assuming that we're actually going to get all that money back. But as I said, there are bills flowing through you know, the legislature that might take the whole thing away. So right now, while we're not up to what we actually got back last year, we're getting closer. We bumped that up another $50,000. Again, we talked about realistic revenue and expenditure budgeting. And an $18,000 reduction in budgeted senior tax abatement and freeze. And the reason we did that is we literally looked at what did we spend last year, and we just carried that over. Generally, that's been that number has been trending down and down. We have two programs. One's an abatement program, where if you qualify financially, you just don't have to pay the taxes. The other is a deferment, which means you don't pay it now. It's a tiny interest rate, and eventually it gets paid off with the house, usually by heirs. Very few people, surprisingly or not, avail themselves of that part of the program. They much rather have the complete abatement. But we do try and make sure that number follows the actual number of usage, otherwise we're over budgeting that. So where are we getting our revenue? Most of it is real estate. 6.3% comes from personal property. Delinquent taxes and interest is another 1.1%. State aid, I know you can't even see that slice, can you? No, and it's going down and down and down. And we don't know what's gonna happen with it, but that's what we get from the state, 0.4%. So, you know, if they pull that away, it's gonna hurt, but basically we are self-sufficient, and that's a very good thing. And then there's local non-tax revenue, fees, other types of stuff. History of state aid for Weston, just mentioned it. 2013, those are the good years, right? Look at that, $1.5 million. Right now, $320,000. That's great. We've had to actually really tighten our belts. A lot of that impact has gone into mill rate. A lot of it has gone down into sort of streamlining operations and services. Good news is there's not much farther for it to fall. The bad news is we've gotten it chopped a massive degree, and it's a shame. But, you know, the whole state's in a tight position. We understand Weston is willing to contribute our share to be self-sufficient to help the state out. So right now, here's the bad part. We're looking at an overall increase in the town operating budget of about 3.3%. This is primarily driven by three factors, okay? Salary increases, which are contractually obligated, contractually negotiated. They basically trend slightly below cost of living, but we have to basically negotiate that constantly. Happens Board of Ed, happens with us, happens with everyone else. You know, employees need to keep up with the cost of living as well. So that's built in, that's negotiated. That accounts for $177,000. State mandated pension costs. I talked about the pension issue, the first year's drop. was the MRF cost. What that looks like for us is $177,000 every year increased on our budget for the next 5 years. Roughly $135,000 accounts for each 1% in our budget. This one item alone is like 1.3% to 1.5% of our budget increase. Just this one thing that showed up literally, what, a week ago, Jonathan?
Yeah.
A week ago, okay? So without that sitting here already, you could see we'd be down around 2%. Without these two plus the new, everybody recalls we hired a new SRO off budget because sort of another mass shooting had happened. We needed to sort of, you know, do our part to address it. We had an SRO in high school, which was exceedingly successful. The program has been fantastic, has headed off a lot of issues. Rightfully, the school and the police, and we supported the deployment of an SRO in the middle school. That program is going fantastically. Everything I heard about it is great, but it does cost money. It requires taking somebody off patrol and putting them in the SRO position for at least, you know, the amount of time that they actually serve. I mean, obviously they're not full-time because school has breaks. And that is a cost because we have to hire a new officer. We also, along with that, decided to beef up the mile of safety. As you recall, we have vehicles, police vehicles, and police presence on the campus. We used to have it just in the morning and just in the afternoon. We decided to fill that donut hole to make sure that there was at least an active uniform presence at all times at the school, that people thought it was important. School safety is a critical issue in this country at the moment. We have one of the safest districts probably in the country. We have our police station right adjacent to our school campus. We have a regional crime lab on campus. We have police everywhere. It is fantastic. Weston's an exceedingly safe town. I'm glad because I have two kids in the school system. Thank you, police, commissioners, school, everyone else who approved it. And the other is a medical insurance rate increase. We know that comes, but surprisingly, this isn't a big driver. Together, all of this, actually, these few things, account for that entire 3.3%. Without those three things that salary increases, contractually obligated, can't do anything about, happens all the time, pension costs were just put to us, and the SRO, which approved, we would have had a negative budget. But woulda, coulda, shoulda, right? We are where we are. Just wanted to let you know that, you know, Jonathan and Rick did an amazing job with all the directors of coming in with as tight a budget as possible. We started out somewhat higher than this, but we got it down, but I think everybody submitted a reasonable budget. Hopefully we can grant everybody's requests in the forthcoming years, but right now with the reval and with these items that came up, our philosophy of the rest of the budget was only critical increases. And I'll talk about the few of those that actually were.
Chris, a quick question, if you would. The state mandated pension cost, is that an increase or what?
No, what they did was, rightfully so, I believe, they changed the return assumption from 7% expected return to 8% to 7%. Yeah, okay. But because the employee contribution is 2.5% and it's such a large fund and needs all payout, what it in effect means is massive increases on part of somebody, and that tends to be the employer, and the town is the employer. So the employer contribution goes up because the employee contribution can't, basically, or hasn't. So that's what accounts for the whole thing. But basically what that means is we're paying close to $1 million after this 5 years that we weren't paying before, just based on assumptions of returns. So if the market starts going gangbusters again and they revise it back up, we'll be in good shape. But if not, we're where we are. Hopefully they don't bring it down again to 6%. Oh, the town budget's about 6.5% now, and we think that's a pretty fair return on our OPEB. Other pension and other post-employment benefits, which is basically our kind of version of the pension for that space, we're budgeting about 6.5%, so I don't think it'll go much lower than that unless the market changes substantially. So where does that 3.3 look like in terms of history? Well, you know, it's higher than it has been a lot, but you know, it's not out of the ballpark. I would like to keep that as a cap, and that's something we're gonna certainly do. I want it to come down more. I gotta be honest, in the next 5 years, it's gonna be a tough thing to do, knowing that, you know, 1.5% of that alone is gonna be eaten up by that MERS cost, and another 2.5% is gonna be eaten up by salary increases, basically. So it's tough. So basically, this year, what we had to do, and we're going to look every year out, is look at service reductions. And we unfortunately had to start talking about that. We'll get into it a little bit during this budget. This is a breakdown of where the money goes. General government, which is just like paperwork running everything, staff kind of critical things, 19%, insurance, 20%. It's amazing, right? Just think about that. And that's not even including pension and FICA. Add those things together, you got 30% of our budget is going to sort of benefits. Public safety, a measly 22%. We could always use more, but being that we're always rated like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 top safest towns, it's worth the investment. Public works, our roads, that's kind of what we have, right? And that number we're actually underinvesting have traditionally underinvested. We literally continue to underinvest now, but again, with these other budget pressures, we just can't true it up yet. Sanitation health is a small 3% piece, human services, parks and rec, et cetera. Size of workforce over time, I mentioned this last year, bending this curve is gonna be critical to sort of controlling the expenses over time. We continue to do that. We had some time hour reductions within internal existing staff. We're doing some shakeups in terms of some of the services we're providing. But this is where, if we can find it, is the only place that we could actually bend the curve at all. Capital budget, it's high. And it's high primarily because the Board of Ed has a fairly large increase this year. Part of it is catch up on a lot of sort of physical infrastructure stuff, boilers, systems, plumbing, that type of thing. We talked about that before, but that's what we're trying to do. Town is asking for 657. We'll go into that a little bit in a little while, but that's primarily all for things like different forms of trucks, mowers, that kind of deal. Really physical, large scale stuff. Stuff that lasts usually 20 plus years and has to be replaced in some cycle like that, but it's not technically part of the operating budget. Combined, the Board of Selectmen, the Board of Education capital budgets, which technically the Board of Selectmen control the capital budget, is an increase of about $177,000 or 9% over current fiscal year. There's a $70,000 decrease in the Board of Selectmen, so we are down actually. The Board of Selectmen is putting forward a budget that's actually down below last year's again because we recognize these budget pressures and we tried to be a bit more creative how we allocated capital expenditures. I would love to true that up and bring that up, but now is not the time. And the Board of Ed has a $248,000 increase in gross expenditures. The above figures are offset by $540,000 that we accrued based on the closing of a capital construction account that we had in there. I generally don't like to plug holes with large buildups in capital accounts because what you get is what we had this year, which was a large bounce back. So that $540,000 is kind of going to be a hill that we have to climb in addition to whatever we increase next year. But we did feel that because we had the money and because of the reval and the overall budgets, it would be reasonable at this time to deploy it for that purpose. That again, we will have to decide and debate that in the Board of Finance, I would say. Where is the capital items for town going? A huge chunk of it, $380,000, is going to the vehicle sinking fund, which is a long-term fund that we use to basically put in money for large trucks, vehicles, things like that. In that is $250,000 for a 10-wheel dump truck. Ours is about to go, is my understanding. We did query on that. Can we spread it out over a couple of years and see how that goes? It looks like it's going. We don't want to be, you know, out the truck in the middle of budget season and go for a supplemental for $250,000. On that note, though, we did talk last year about starting this installment program where there was something that looked like it might go. Let's see how long we can drag it out to maybe get 2 or 3 years out of it, and we'll put an installment each year on it, and if for some reason it goes, we'll come back for a supplemental, but if for some reason we make it to the end of that, we extended its life, and we minimized or smoothed out sort of the capital outlay. So that's going forward. We've got a second installment for a snow removal truck, and a second installment for a new road grader, and that's for flattening out sort of bumpy dirt roads. We've got the first installment of a new tractor mower that's dead. That's the vehicles they use to mow the sides of the roads. Town building repairs, $60,000. That's for all town buildings around town. $60,000 is all we invest in upkeep. Transfer station scale, we're putting in the third installment of $33,000. It's the final installment. That thing was from the 70s? Second installment?
Yep. Second and final.
Second and final. Okay, that was two installments, because we got it cheaper. It was originally going to be $100,000. We ended up getting it for about 60-something thousand. So we're just bringing it up now. So that was actually a savings. Sorry. So it was the second and final, not the third and final. And then an asphalt box of DPW. Like I said, we are underinvesting in public works. We're going to continue to, but to partially offset that, we acknowledge that we're going to be dragging out some road fixes that we need to sort of do earlier, but roads are really expensive. So what Lou Mariano, DPW director, asked for is what's called an asphalt hot box, which keeps the asphalt warm and melty, so it's really easier to patch those potholes. So we expect more potholes because we just don't have the money to do every road that we need to. We hope, and this year we're actually going to bump that budget line up by about $50,000. I would like to propose we do that every year till we sort of catch up to where we need to be. So we're increasing that budget a little, but we probably need it like a full $1 million to true up and to get up to speed of where we need to be with road paving. But I acknowledge that it's going to be a tough thing to suggest now, but it is something we need to talk about in the future, and we can talk a little bit now. Some of the capital items from the Board of Ed to note is security initiatives, and I don't want to go into a lot of detail with that, but let's just say it's hardcore security upgrades. These are long-term things. This may be moved out of this into reserve because we're doing a large-scale campus-wide security fix, and it may meet the criteria to sort of move it into that, which means it would come out of the mill rate line, which would be good, and we'd use that capital reserve of 18% that we talked about to accomplish this. We just need to have a little more understanding of what those expenses are, make sure they meet criteria for that, and then, you know, I think Board of Finance, and we can certainly talk about that. Oil tank sinking fund, this is only to remove old oil tanks we're not going to bury anymore. It's my sort of personal battle to make sure we don't put in more oil tanks around the school in the wetlands. So I'm glad they're not proposing it. The xenon plant control. The xenon plant is basically our plumbing infrastructure for the whole school. They're finally kind of upgrading and keeping up. If that thing fails, it means that a lot of the schools no longer have functioning plumbing, and nobody wants to see that. So we're going to avoid that. Chiller and vent system in Hurlbut. That school is really old. Those things are like literally failing. They're costing something like $40,000 or $50,000. A year to maintain anyway, so we think it's reasonable to support them in just saying, hey, let's fix it and stop paying that. Same thing with water heaters at Hurlbut in the high school, and a boiler and piping. These are all like things that are just kind of crumbling as we speak and costing a lot more money than we would expect to keep it going. So that's why that number is so big. I did query them on all the individual items, and you know they put forward a pretty good defense of it. But what that ends up looking like is this light blue line is town. We're kind of in trend. We're going to be around $800,000 a year from now, you know, maybe incremented out, you know, 3% a year for inflation or whatever. But that's kind of where we are. So we are at trend. Town has done. That was part of that 19, if you remember, was a turf replacement, a full field replacement. But this year is support of this infrastructure implementation plan, and you know it's probably much needed, and it will basically hopefully offset repair costs, and we did some querying on that too. History of capital budgets, again combined budgets, taking out the offsets because again the capital, the vehicle, the turf replacement, there's a turf replacement fund that you put in money every year, and then basically once you get the fund you trigger it and have to basically spend the money, but then you offset the whole thing. So taking all those sort of offset machinations out, you can see general trend, we're probably talking, you know, somewhere in $1 million or $1.2 million if you were going to draw sort of a trend line across that thing. For a couple of years we underinvested,
we had large offsets
too. Total budget including BOE, this is what it looks like. Where's the money going? BOE operating 72%. throw another seven, it's not showing up there, but that 7%, I believe, is the BOE cap.
Yeah, it is.
Somewhere in there, color-wise. Town itself is about 18% of that overall thing. And then debt service is this tiny red slice. The good news is that tiny red slice is going to be getting tinier and tinier until 23, 24, where current $6 million we're spending on debt service goes to zero, assuming no new capital spends. And so far, all the big capital projects we have are coming out of reserve. So, I mean, I'm not going to be realistic. There's a lot of money that needs to be invested in schools based on their 10-year plan. And at some point, that'll probably have to be revisited. That's where we are now. Town debt, as I mentioned, we are going down, 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 and these numbers continue to plummet till 23-24. I've mentioned that we did do a debt refunding, which enabled us to basically restructure the existing debt that we had, not extend the terms out, not increase the amounts, but what it did realize was a $260,000-ish savings for just structurally, and that's net of the cost of the financing, et cetera. So we saved about $260,000 by basically restructuring and refunding our debt. Mill rate history, this is the overall combined, not just the town part, but the town and the town Board of Ed operating plus the town Board of Ed capital budgets, factoring in everything else, revenues, et cetera. We're looking at about a 3.5% overall mill rate increase. Again, that doesn't include the reval effects. And remember, the reval effects are not equal. Everybody doesn't go up based on the amount that the ground list goes down. High-end houses went down significantly more than low-end houses. So what you're seeing with the reval effect is high-end homeowners, because their houses are worth less, are going to be paying less of a proportion, and their taxes could potentially go down, even under this scenario. And in fact, this is pretty close to the scenario that we presented when we did the reval. If you remember, we did have a column that displayed reval effects, and we actually had a dollar amount. So for the low-end houses, this 3.54% is going to translate, and this is for $350,000 to $550,000 houses, a $600 increase on their taxes. The house is over $2 million, it still looks like they might be going down a little bit. So it's kind of a weird effect, but that's what's going to happen out of the reval. But this is the overall mill rate increase if everything holds as presented here. And here's a very, very, very crowded chart. I will point out some of the key figures. Town operating budget here is 332. Again, that is accounted for by three items. Without those three items, we are negative, but I can't say, you know, aside from that, how is the play, right? It is what it is. Board of Ed at this moment, they put forth a 3.93 budget. I actually think it's somewhat higher because they didn't, at the time they passed their budget, they did not factor in their MERS effect, which is roughly 100,000. So I think they're closer to 4.1 now, as is, which is a hefty amount. And remember, therefore, their 3.3, if they had one, is not equivalent to ours. It has about four times the impact. So we're talking in terms of the town is going to increase spending expenses by about $433,000. The Board of Ed's up there around $2 million increase. Capital budgets, as I said, towns is down. We're down by about 10%. Remember, there's an offset in here, which is right here. Board of Ed, like I said, is up 21%, and I did mention that 300 and something thousand is probably going to come out of that, and I think it's much needed, and if we could find a way to do it, it would be much better to not have that in the mill rate and look at it from the reserves, because it is a security fix, and there are long-term fixes and changes that are going to be done. Total capital budget, though, is up significantly because we had large offsets last year again. We had one offset for the turf replacement, and another one from another capital account that we had. Debt service, great news. I wish all the budget looked like that. But total gross, we're up 4.2%, less revenues, 4.93. Puts us down here. Keep in mind the grand list overall is about 6.28%. I did mention 6.75%. That was the real estate value
decrease in the grant list, but car taxes and personal property in particular were up, so that brought the overall grant list decrease down to 6.3%. If you take that out of the revale again, we're at 3.54%. And I wish there were better news, but that's where we are right now. So I will open it up to questions from my colleagues, discussions. One thing I wanted to sort of ask was, do you want to go with specific questions, or do you want to go section by section?
I think section by section might be useful.
Okay, one thing I want to be aware of is Bill Lomas is kind of near the end of it, and he has kind of an important, if we could jump to that quickly. The reason I say that is because he's one of the few places we're investing, and we're investing for a pretty critical issue, and I don't want it to get washed out. So we're talking.
Bill, you want to come up first?
Sure.
He is tab number, Bill is tab number 20. So just a little background on this while Chris gets ready. This tree warden budget was created. It's actually established in budget year 17-18. Prior to that, the tree service money was in the public works budget, but state law called for a tree warden to be appointed. Tree warden had to have some specific qualifications. Bill had those, so the Board of Selectmen at the time appointed Bill tree warden. Voila, we have a new budget. Money came out of the public works budget for tree cutting and went in here. That's why if you just see the actual 16-17 column, there's nothing in there.
Right.
Bill has been extremely busy the past few years with doing two roles. One is shepherding EverSource through town.
$1.5 million probably,
yeah,
now? Work?
They've done
work.
Millions of work in dollars of work in town, helping them cut down trees that are their responsibility. And then the money you see here is to cut down trees that are not EverSource's responsibility and are the town's responsibility. So we do propose an increase, and
The increase is substantial. It's a
it's in the
$21,000 change, and that's all for tree work. He actually had asked for more, and I wish I could give more, and maybe I am willing to give a supplemental if we end up needing it, because what we have now is, if the state pension issues weren't enough, we have almost a natural catastrophe happening. There's something called the emerald ash borer beetle that loves ash trees. We have tons of ash trees. They tend to be the trees. If you look around, they go straight up about 80 to 100 feet. And ash borers are unbelievably effective tree parasites. And I don't even know what.
They're insects, yeah. it's a beetle that was brought into the United States in packing crates from Asia, and it started in Detroit area, and now is in 32 states. The emerald ash borer has no natural enemies. They're trying to introduce some wasps right now as predatory wasps, but how that ultimately works out isn't going to do too much for this generation of trees. The long and the short of it is, we started seeing the emerald ash borer here in 2014-2015, and there's what happens is, essentially, we go from your initial indication that the emerald ash borer is here. It started at about 8% infestation, and that doubles every single year. So we're at 16, 32, 64, and within the next year to year and a half, we're going to be 100% infested in Weston. So the likelihood is, close to 100% death of the trees. Hopefully, in the future, they'll, off the stumps themselves will grow saplings, and they'll have come up with a solution to this. This issue, they will crash because they won't have any food left, but that doesn't do anything for the trees that are already dead, right? They're already out there. We have 80 miles of roads. There's also state roads, and I'm also keeping the state informed as to the issues along 57 and 53, and actually parts of Northfield. if you look at the number of ash trees on a percentage basis of our trees, it's between 5% and 10%. And you are looking at about 200 trees per mile. That's just on average.
On the roadside.
On the roads.
Right.
Alongs, and you know, the road varies. You know, some roads are 40 feet, some roads are 50 feet in width. But the long and the short of it is we're probably going to be looking at, when all these are done, between 800 and 1600 trees.
Yeah. And once the tree dies, it's got a year, and then usually they fall.
Well, yeah. I mean, the problem with ash trees, you know, obviously they're native species, but the problem is once they get this disease and they die, typically within a year, you start having limbs falling out of the trees. You know, obviously as the tree dies, it weakens, and structurally the tree isn't going to hold up in the storms or anything else. That's just the emerald ash borer. Okay, so we had about, at the time, and historically, we have been underinvesting in the town for doing tree work. And even during that underinvestment time, we were about $1,000 a tree when we had the monies that were being utilized. In coordination with the DPW and our arborists that we're utilizing, we brought that cost down to about $500 a tree. So we're getting twice the bang for our buck, but we have a lot of trees that are going to be coming down. There's other things that are going on in town and in the state. You've had a 5-year drought, even though you wouldn't know it lately, and that stressed a lot of trees out. You've also had storms. We spent about $65,000 plus last year in expenses. We had a $45,000 budget, and then I had a $45,000 budget, and then I had $40,000, another $25,000. Added on for the storm work that we did. You've also got in the eastern part of the state, because of the drought, we had gypsy moths. Anybody who's been to the eastern part of the state has seen the devastation of the oaks from the eastern part into Rhode Island. We're just very fortunate we didn't have that occurring here, but it can.
So basically the bottom line is that Bill has been asking to implement a program to sort of catch us up, because the trees we don't take down in advance, we're taking down with emergency over time when these heavy storms come, and more and more of them are coming. And these are all roadside trees, and then you have the addition of not only expense, but usually it takes down a power line, because this is Weston and it blocks a road. During one storm last year, we had like 220 of our 260 roads impacted, blocked by either down tree or down power line, and somewhat problematic passage through. So Bill had actually come and asked us for $94,000. We looked at everything we looked at, you know, and you all saw the budget. Nobody's happy about it. We did reduce that somewhat, but we still did believe that we needed to increase the investment in there. Everywhere else, we tried to sort of hold ground or do minimal sort of investment, just because, you know, the pension pushback and everything else that's going on. So that's kind of where we are. I at least believe that if this becomes insufficient because we see more of a spread or because more of a storm impact, I would be willing to go ahead and go with supplemental, which we've done for you in the past, you know, without much hassle.
As an aside too, the area towns around us have been asking for increased budgets. There've been numerous articles in the papers, especially the Hartford Current, talking about the millions of trees that are dying in Connecticut. So it's not gonna stop. We're gonna have this on an ongoing basis, and just like deferring out on your, you know, your capital expenditures, you're gonna have to pay for it at some point. If these trees start coming down, you know, you've got issues around town. I'd rather get them down before they drop. I mean, that's the long and the short of it. Other towns have been asking for double and triple their budgets, and some of them getting very substantial increases. I understand Reading has asked and seen that they have close to 800 trees that they've gone ahead and designated as trees that need to be removed. That's what I understand. You know, again, it's what they're doing there and what we're doing here is differently, but fortunately, with what we're doing and with working with Eversource closely, we're getting our arms around it.
Okay, so I think you get the picture.
Yeah.
And this includes all the removal, right? This number includes all the removal,
including grinding
and chipping.
We've been trying really hard to. We take the wood, we bring. We can't chip most of it on site because we'd be chipping it in someone's front yard. So we'll either chip it and take it back and set it out for people to take at the transfer station, or we bring a lot of the wood back in the dump trucks, and then the crew will chop it up in bigger pieces and we give it away to people like Don Egan, who will. Or give it away to places who will even sell it. There's a place on Route 7 who will chop it up, take the time to chop it up and sell it. Or we'll chop it up and give it to Don to sell for the Weston Warm-Up Fund. So, but there's so much now, we can't do all of it. And so there's some money in here to tub grind if necessary.
Some of the outlying towns, a lot of people will take the wood, go ahead and cut it up and use it for firewood, bring it to the house. You can't transfer wood interstate either because of the ash borer.
Right.
And you can see those signs at the borderline. But and we don't grind that often. We don't grind stumps. It's only if they're going to be create a problem for, you know, the trucks and whatnot for plowing, because it's a very, very expensive thing to do for every tree we cut down. It's just impossible.
One of the things of note, and I'm sorry I had to run out and get something really quick, is this again could be one of those budgets which over the next few years there's a $10,000 increase every year to get it up to maybe where it needs to be. It is, I know Bill's been kind of overwhelmed this year in terms of he'll create a list of trees that need to come down. DPW will compare notes and they'll just say there's not enough money to cut down both the trees on all the, you know, the two lists. And he's done yeoman's work trying to prioritize which ones, you know, are more dangerous than the others.
And anybody that's out there driving the roads will see these trees. They're gray and they're mottled brown. You can see them on the side of the road very often. There's the bark underneath the trees, all around the trees from the emerald ash borer. It's not the emerald ash borer denuding the trees. It's the woodpeckers coming in to go after the emerald ash borers and are stripping the trees. And that's once that happens, the tree's gone.
Yeah, I've been familiar with the issue for a long time. I'm noticing a lot of more of those model trees around town.
It's going to double.
I have no doubt that it's going to be a very exponential problem.
I posted 15 trees today in a span of about 300 yards.
Okay. So, I mean, yeah. I thought that number was a reasonable number, initial investment.
I would agree. Yeah, okay.
Thank you, Bill.
Thanks.
Thank you. Please support, keep us all updated.
We're just tight on
Yeah, that we're trying to do more outreach to the public, and Bill has been talking to us about coming up with some mechanism for letting people identify, and maybe we'll do it through LaShot or something. That would be great, or through the environment. But yes, that's a good point, because those, for example, and I don't want to go into much detail because I've got a lot of departments here, a huge proportion of the trees that took down power lines were on private property. So that point is key. Bill's been screaming rightfully about it. I don't think we've gotten up to speed enough of educating the public about it enough, but private trees along the edges that are dying are going to cost everybody time and money and, unfortunately, electricity too.
Chris, so maybe we could set up an appointment with Chris and Ted Kraft to do something that'll get in the paper at the Weston.
Yeah. It would be a good thing for the media to think about.
Yeah, and hopefully we'll see something from the state, but the state, you know, is kind of conditional states it, but there are a lot of towns that are very, very concerned about, you know, how they're going to pay for all this.
We're lucky to have you and what you're doing with Eversource. Margaret, we really got to.
I voluntarily.
So let's start with tab 1, administration and finance. Questions?
some explanation, the wage contingency is in there as expected payments.
Yeah, we made an effort, and I'd love some feedback after the process of really enhancing the notes on the bottom to sort of explain some of the more aberrant numbers.
Yeah, those were useful.
Yes, that's a revenue question.
Maybe we can do revenues at the end, is that okay?
We'll do that revenues at the end.
Just because we have the
staff.
No, just, I'm sorry, just because we have the folks here just to talk more about.
The staff people for each of these.
Sorry, you are right, that is very in front.
Yes.
Just going in order?
Moving on to number two, there are notes at the bottom. This is still in flux, I'm still working with KERMA on the workers' comp insurance and the liability auto property life insurance. Those are two really big numbers which are in flux. So there will be more detail attached to this. I just got to work that out with KERMA. You know, the most significant increases here, or increases of note, are if you take it from the top and go down, contractual services is a myriad of things that we do to the building, whether it be pumping out your septic system or actually our agreements sometimes, or our payments, I think even to vendors that are of a routine nature come out. We go down to, so that's just a modest increase to pay for that, 3.3%. I will get a list of that to you once this the backup is available.
We do
have
a breakout.
I'm sorry, I do.
Yeah, it's not in the book, but we have it. We'll provide it.
That should be.
Is it in the back? Sorry.
No, I think it is break one of the first pages.
Is it? I missed it. I'm sorry.
Not yet.
Nope.
Depends.
General admin, the numbers seem to match up.
I'm missing. Yes, you have it.
I do not
have it. I don't have it. You have it. Yeah. Yeah, I just don't, I'm missing that page.
Yeah, I don't
so
have it.
So they got it.
They got
so
it.
We did get it.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's one of us.
The two important people. I've seen it before, so.
Just unemployment comp, just some notes, is up a little bit. We'll talk about that. We do expect some reduction in hours in the transfer station.
As we reduce hours of staff, you expect it to come back in unemployment.
You see the pension cost, that's the CMERS cost. And again, this incremental increase is something we can expect to get over the next five budgets.
The same increase, so next year we're looking at that no matter what we do.
Moving down the line, electricity comes down from 81,000 from last year to 65, that's due to virtual net metering.
Yeah, what? That is just a staggeringly large number, even with the deduction. That's just what it costs to light the place up.
Light and air condition and
just here
computers.
We pay for Jarvis House there. We pay for our portion of the Pearl Buck, the senior center situated over there. So there's
fire, police.
Yeah, there's
that is every. That's every electricity account we have. Street lights.
Library.
Believe it or not, we do have like 18.
Library too?
No, that's every electricity account except library and public works. And a few little ones here and there with the water systems.
And again, we're LED over everywhere. We're switching
the ballparks. It's,
Electricity is.
Okay, all right.
Any more questions here?
Yeah, Georgetown Fire District. Now,
We're talking to them now.
Okay.
I met with them. I met with them about 4 weeks ago. Sat down with them. They explained how we get charged, what we get charged by them, and Rick, is that a payment out of contractual services? Yeah, it's about $100,000-ish. We're waiting whether or not that's going to go up. And actually, we pay less than Reading. We pay less than Wilson. It's based on our assessed values. That's how they figure it out. They take the assessed values for real estate.
Mm-hmm.
It's just real estate values. It's
but
not,
the overall
it's
cost
not.
Is going up because it services Meadowbrook.
Meadow Ridge.
And they are large utilizers of services.
We jumped up last year because of other towns having a revaluation. And this year, because we're having our reval and the assessments will go down, I think we may stay steady or we maybe even get a little drop, but we don't know yet. Interestingly, Reading sends out their bills to individual homeowners. Wilton and Weston, I think, just pay directly. Our homeowners in the district don't get bills.
Now, does Reading give those homeowners who get billed a deduction on the rest of their property taxes?
No.
No?
No, we can build the pay.
Yeah, so we have a good deal, but we have volunteer fire department.
Yeah, we went back and forth on this, and we thought, well, you know, in a way, should we do the same? And we're just like, I don't think it makes sense, because the folks...
Because they're paying for some of the benefits.
Yeah, would be paying Reading, and then they'd also be paying for services here.
So we have to carve that up, and we could discuss that going forward if it gets...
Yeah, I mean, we should probably understand it with greater clarity. I thought the state statute said that they should be assessing the homes in their district.
They have the option. I met with their accountant and their tax collector a couple weeks ago. They said we have the option. We could request, I don't know the legal procedure to make that so, but we could request that they just send the bills to the homes in the Weston that are in the district. So yeah, that would reduce our budget by $100,000. Yeah. It would put costs on them.
Doesn't sound necessarily like a good idea.
No.
But I think we should get understand.
And we are in discussion. Yeah. They are complicated to schedule meetings with, let's put it that way. So we're trying to have these discussions. Jonathan has been, he's been able to manage. They move it. I've been
now, trying. Now, I do have, I did ask them. I said, you know, what is the root of this formula? And they just said, this is the way we've always done it. Now, but at the end of the day, I look at the assessments, and ours is the lowest out of the three towns. So I'm like, I hesitate to say, should we, you know, is this the time to engage in discussions about rejiggering the formula? Yeah. I don't know. Maybe it would go down lower. I don't know, but one step at a time.
And until we know what the formula says, messing with it, you know, we don't know what's going
on.
But that is an ongoing discussion, and you make a valid point on that. So we'll certainly let you know when we get a little more clarity. Section 3, IT.
So IT is this year, at the kind of mandate of the Board of Finance, last minute mandate, we received IT services from the Board of Ed. So we paid them money. We also, they provided service directly to us. That will change next year. We will be receiving services. Our frontline services will come from a company called Novus. This is a company that we talked about last year potentially going with. So Novus will provide services to town staff. If there is an absolute emergency backup, then school staff would provide backup. The check, however, is going to be provided to pay Novus would be provided to the Board of Ed, and they would provide pay Novus. And I believe that's the reason. The reason for that is because the Board of Ed, I think, may purchase some services from Novus. So there's some economies of scale in terms of having one purchase point. The contractual services, if you take a look at the detail on the next page, we've managed to drop contractual services a little bit, and that's mostly just from competitive bidding, especially with the website. Our website cost this year and this budget's higher, being a one-time cost, and we put in as we all talked about at length, we put in a CRM, which would have allowed, we were looking for something like a C-Click-6, and the website that we bought is going to incorporate that, so there's some savings there. In the contractual services line, if you look at equipment, it's a similar number to what we purchased last year. It's kind of what we need to do in order to just keep refreshing our PCs. And down in telecommunications, we had to add in some costs that kind of got lost last year in the budgeting process. So overall, we still managed to keep the budget to a 3.35% increase.
So the frontier is really something that happened last year. We're just reflecting it this year.
One of the difficult things with the frontier bills is we've charged, and this is what I've learned this year, historically, we went through all of the bills for Frontier, went through every single bill that we get for telecommunications, modems, internet, Frontier, alarm systems. And what we discovered that a lot of the bills are charged to the Tower Fund account. And so last year, we kind of moved over a lot more bills, I did, than we should have. We really should only be charging Tower Fund expenses to items tangentially related to the Tower Fund.
Hence the big change.
So, so we charge way more this year than we need to, and next year is kind of a truing up model.
We have a multifunction copier in the town clerk's office for $6,000.
Yeah, we do.
It is something that could be leased. Is that something that copies surveys? It seems like very high number.
It copies all legal documents that are 11x17 or smaller, and this is going to. It's my goal to have this replace some of the smaller copiers that are around because we get better copy pricing. We really do need a copy machine in that office for purchasing. So my hope is $6,000, you know, the one down the hall here has lasted 13 years. I think probably the one in the town clerk's office is like 15 years old, probably. So I think, you know, we keep them and we hold them, and we get these maintenance contracts as well, which are bringing our per copy cost down really low, but they give us free toner as well and free maintenance associated with that. So I think it's a good, I do think it's a good purchase.
It's a good investment.
Yeah, I do think
aside
so.
Aside from, as compared to leasing it?
I believe, based on the analysis I've done, that the cost of the lease is going to cost you more in the end. Mm-hmm. So, and then they'll also come in 6 years down the road and try to upsell you a new model and say, look, your lease will go down, but if you start looking at leasing over 10, 30-year periods, then I think you're paying way more. Mm-hmm. So,
okay.
Section 4, probate court, nothing to say except it's going up 2%, and we don't have a whole lot of say in that. Election registrars is going up because we're going to have a bunch of primaries. One of those big years, lots of primaries, a little bit extra cost.
There's no Republican primaries,
we might save some money there. Right, that's right.
We're assuming that there's going to be two primaries.
But you guys have been doing great work, so we'll try and keep the number of elections down. Board of Finance is Board of Finance. That's their auditing, right?
Yeah, we had a little drop in the audit costs.
A little drop, but
well,
it's a slight increase.
Oh, I'm sorry. Forgive me.
Sliding. Everything's a slight. The problem is cost. We were lucky and unlucky for a few years because the recession, dislocation, whatever you want to call it, 7-8, held cost of living down for a long, long, long time, and now inflation is creeping back up. I think cost of living is close to 2.8 now, 2.6, 7.8.
Yeah, that's probably about right.
So it's now, it used to be like 0.3, 0.4, 0.6. I mean, we were flat, and that means everybody else, every other cost was being kept down. Now we're gonna start to see this creeping in 2, 2.5. If we can keep it under that, we're doing good, but that's just the cost of living increase. Assessor.
One thing to note, just as we get into, and you guys probably already figured this out, but it's worth saying again. When you look at the salaries and wages lines, those do not factor in the anticipated wages that they will get for next year. And it doesn't factor in the anticipated wages for this year.
This current year, because the contracts are negotiated and they're retroactive, so there's an increase.
So next year, when you're sitting here at this time, hopefully, all of you, you'll see like why is there a 6% increase? And well, it's just the catch up from the past 2 years plus the third year or so.
Assessor, they did ask for more staff. It was a hard decision to say we can't do it right now. It's something that will come up again and again. It's not that we don't think that they're doing an excellent job and that the staff would help. It's just that, again, we tried to say wherever possible, if it wasn't something like a plague of beetles, for example, or unanticipated, you know, pension pushdown from the state, to the extent we could push it back. There's a few small areas where we did some very minor investment, but we're trying not to grow staff at this time because staff isn't just a small thing. Like equipment, it comes with benefits and all sorts of other stuff, and it's a long-term and extremely hard to reverse. So staff-wise, we kind of held the line there. Tax collection.
There was just the IT budget had both paying for software costs associated with tax collection in the past, plus printing and other types of costs. And I said, well, those printing and other types of costs really should go on the tax collection.
That was kind of an omnibus thing that we did this time around, right?
Exactly.
Move printing to the individual departments.
Yes. And it's been a long-term sort of initiative that we're trying, and we might get more and more into the individual budgets and out of sort of the bucket budgets, but it's a burden on staff, and we, right now, they're working so hard that we don't want to do it, but to the extent we can true up and put more transparency in individual budget lines, we've gone there. Town clerk has some minor increases.
You skipped over legal counsel.
No.
Legal counsel, of course. Can't forget that. Well, legal counsel's down. Why would you want to talk about that?
Well, they're down from last year, but not from 2017. $80,000 to $150,000, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I do think litigation expenses specifically, not the retainer.
Which we don't get to control.
No, but I guess my question is, is somebody watching the store? Is somebody reviewing that? Do we have our...
We are actually, on a monthly basis, Tracy Kulikowski and Chris and I go over the invoices, each of them, and also what we've asked Ira to do in addition to that. We've asked him for a monthly breakdown of what he's charging us, actually how many hours they're actually spending and what that equates to dollar-wise against the retainer. Mm-hmm. In the first couple of months, what he was actually charging was really high compared to the $8,000-ish retainer.
Oh, way over.
And now we're getting down to like...
Now we're on par.
Right on par. So it's something we're just being mindful of. We don't want to abuse the retainer.
We should bend the legal the court expenses down. You're right. Mm-hmm. To the extent we can, but again...
Because as I understand it, the litigation expenses are completely outside of the retainer, right?
They are. There are some other things outside of the retainer, like, I'm just going to grab an example that's close to us here right now. When we use Chris Hodgson, the labor attorney, to do a special negotiation, like a police contract,
3 minutes now.
Mm-hmm. Then he will say, look, that's outside of the retainer. It's something that's in depth.
Sure.
So, or if we were to revisit the town charter, that type of thing.
Or if there's a special investigation into like employee misconduct, that's just an example. Mm-hmm. Then that would be, outside.
Sometimes we have bond related questions, like with the front office stress.
Exactly.
We had to talk to bond counsel about some issues with that. That's the process.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Anything else here? No. Okay. Now, town clerk.
Town clerk, again, there was one item. There was an item in the IT budget, again, that's been...
That's the 80%.
Yeah, that's been moved
And
out.
Printing, binding, and advertisement is our favorite topic of ordinances. The gift that never will stop giving. Mm-hmm. But there's a cost to now reflect those in printed code, and that's it. So let's be very mindful of those.
I will say that in several of these departments, too, prior to that, that general administration budget in tab 2, the general supplies item was the go-to for people to order their office supplies.
It was a big bucket.
And now we've said, hey, we want you to budget in each of your own departments the funding necessary so that we have a better idea as to what everyone's spending, because when it's being purchased out of a bucket without a detailed list, it's just kind of hard to manage. So you will see in some of these general supplies. So you'll see like in town clerk's $5,738 general supplies. You can see what that is. Printer maintenance, things of that nature, most of them related to printing. So, in general, $900 in general office supplies in that department.
And land use, and if you have any questions, Tracy's here for land use and building.
I don't have any questions for Tracy, but, and I know this is entirely out of P&Z's hands, it's entirely out of our hands, but this increased cost for legal notices, I understand it. Forum is gone. We're going to Stanford Advocate.
I don't know. Maybe we can use the Westport News now that we're being covered as keeper of record. But it's still owned by the same. Yes, but there's a bill actually that has been submitted by some of our reps to allow small towns that lost the physical newspaper to do online publication.
Excellent.
So
we're using an
hour,
by the way.
Yeah, we just have somebody from the Westport News here who's covering us, so that might be our paper record. If they actually have articles about us, people might start subscribing more, and that might have a better circulation and coverage.
We've also eliminated all spacing and any extra words. Anne Marie has got a damn, literally will take words out
as the lines.
But that is a good point, yes.
And it may be something that we can talk to CCM about or WestCog. We pay CCM that subscription, we should get our money's worth.
We
have them lobby for us for that sort of
absolutely
situation.
Absolutely. I will mention something
about that. I do believe there is a bill that talks about the town websites.
Yeah. It might have passed
on the town
website. I think they're just moving. It might have passed committee.
Some other towns also don't have newspapers.
Easton and Reading are examples.
Right. So. Right, and Reading's backup sources.
All over the state it's happening. So there's a discussion, so that's something in there, but right now that's what we're doing. It was more expensive than Weston Forum, so mm-hmm. We had to reflect that because we have to put out legal notices. Thank you, Tracy. Volunteer Fire Department,
Narcan's the big expense, is that, that's in here, right?
Narcan and medical exams increasing.
And medical exams, they're increasing. They have to do what's necessary.
And that's Narcan that mostly be used by EMS and police, not really the fire department, but it's the most appropriate place to put it.
Right, because there's no EMS budget line. Okay, any other questions? Fire marshal, not really any activity there. Got any questions?
Tons of activity.
Let's not go there, but not there. On that note, amazing job, guys, on the last two fires. I mean, that is a big one. Thank you, guys, and we are so lucky to have a volunteer fire department and EMS. Animal control, not a whole lot of activity going on, again.
The most, you know, the driver here is uniforms, there's a, Mark has an assist, a new assistant, and we really got to get him some uniforms that designate who he is, and, you know, Mark as well, just so.
People can recognize when they're on their property.
Right.
So it's not terrifying. Communication center, we did some truing up there, particularly overtime, we kept under budgeting chronically, we decided to true it up, we looked at trend. Trend is roughly 63,000, so we brought it up to that.
Yeah, this does also factors in, you know, some of the wage increases that are anticipated as well.
The wage increases.
We, OJ and I have tried, probably, I've been here for 2 years. We have gotten together and advertised for part-timers probably three times at least, three or four times, and we've hired two, and we just keep going out for more. Well, you know, we don't want to just flood the market, but we'll put out an ad, we'll go through our process, we'll wait 2 months, we'll put out an ad, we'll go through our process. We're always trying to get more part-timers. It's just very hard to find.
Mm-hmm. It's a tough job, because you're working midnight shifts and stuff, in the high stress environment, you know. Emergency medical communication service is just what we have to pay, and that went up a good deal. But that was the assessment they gave us, and that's just what it cost. Regional paramedic, same thing. They tell us what it costs. That's out of Norwalk.
Yeah.
And they just, again, give us the increase.
Yeah, I actually entered into an agreement for that. This year is the last year of the multi-year agreement.
Okay.
So this was just an estimate.
Oh, it's an estimate.
So it's from them.
Right.
From them.
Police, again, basically would have been pretty much flat. The only increase is from, remember we did a supplemental last year for the SRO and for the overtime, so that's accounting for the entire change. I want to congratulate you guys on keeping this budget very tight. Doing a good job, really appreciate it. Town appreciates it.
One of the things we did do is the request for overtime was 214,834 based on discussions with the chief. And just doing some due diligence, trying to find some savings, we did drop it to 205.
And the reason we did that is we looked at the current projected trend, and it's about 177. So we still left it way elevated from what trend is, but we did want to bring it down a little bit because every place we can, knowing that if we run over, we will obviously.
We've also had an exceptional amount of good luck in terms of, you know, people not being injured on the job, which is fantastic.
As well as
an exceptional amount of effort.
And good equipment.
Yeah, as well as an exceptional amount of effort to keep overtime down.
Thank you, appreciate it. And we have a new system called POS that's a sort of a scheduling system that's, my understanding, is helping and was a good investment and is already showing a reasonable ROI on that. Any questions on that?
No.
Okay, we're up to public works. That's a big one. This is a big area. One of the things we started looking at.
If we eliminated part-time salaries, we just dropped it because we'd been budgeting three part-timers and we just decided to go with two. So
there's, the size of the roads are going to be a little bit shaggier.
Those are college and high school kids.
But,
training and professional development has increased. That's one thing the new public works director is big on, particularly safety training and making sure they go out and get their flagger certification, chainsaw, continued chainsaw safety, chipper safety, really highly dangerous activities.
And giving
and
the,
to his credit, he wants to do more training.
And giving the foreman more training and sort of managerial level stuff so that they have kind of
a pipeline, which they haven't had historically. So making sure that the foremen are sort of learning some of the business and that kind of boss training. And it's also a safety issue. Yep.
Jonathan, can you talk a little bit about the request for $716,000 for resurfacing roads versus the $550,000?
Yeah. So previous director, Joe Lametta, who'd been here for 40 years, had a philosophy that probably his predecessor had, and that was his goal was to repave every year after it was 20 years old. And so when Lou came in, I said, you know, you're new, you've worked other places, let me know if that works for you, if you want to do something different. And we agreed that what he would do is he would go out and evaluate roads. And so his guys helped him to do that as well. And he came back with a list of roads that were in really poor condition. And he said, you know, some of the roads that exceed 20 years old. And I think what we think has happened is, a road will hit 20 years, but you don't pave it because there's another road that's 16 years old and in much worse shape. So you do the road that's 16 years old. And so we had, that was happening all over town in various roads due to whatever condition, weather, topography, the way people drive. And we had this collection of roads that were old and really in bad shape. So he has said, look, in order for me to start catching up on this 20-year plan, I need like $716,000. And he provided some backup data that shows conditions of roads. You have roads over, I think, close to $2 million in there that he would like to pave. And we just said, we can't swing it. So what we said was, this seems like a significant issue. It's a major asset in town. And it's something we can't just let just go by the wayside. So Chris and I talked to Lou, and what we believe is a $50,000 increase is what we can give given that increase. But of that $50,000, one of the things he has to do is engage an engineering firm to help him not only assess the roads with newer technologies that are available, but also to create a plan as to how we're going to do this going forward over a 10-year plan, a 20-year plan. This may be something, some communities bond for their roads to do catch-ups. We really don't want to do that. But this may be something where we come back next year after doing this analysis and we say we have a 20-year plan, but in order to play catch-up, we have to put in 25 a year for the next 6 years, and we also have to use maybe $500,000 or $1 million of reserve in order to do catch-up. So,
and this includes, we were talking about with the website, that there'll be a way to sort of notify of a road.
It doesn't go through me, hopefully.
No, it the website does have like a,
because that's how it works now.
A site on Public Works,
yeah,
that you could just say, here's my name, here's the pothole.
But it's, if it's more track, accessible, yeah. I just want to make sure that they're also putting that into account.
Of note in this budget, there's a general.
Because now, yeah, we're going to, yeah, say, hey, contact us directly, we're going to give you an easy way to do it. And if we don't have in our budget a way to be responsive, I just, yeah, want to make sure.
Yeah, well, the sites we looked at, the top ones we identified, do have that functionality.
Well, one of the, and this goes to the asphalt hot box that Chris talked about purchasing for $35,000 in the capital, mm-hmm, fund. The director has said, look, I have to send someone out to the plant to get material and come all the way back and then
come back a second time.
And there's no way to heat it and keep it going. So the asphalt hot box through the heating mechanism that they have attached to this box can keep it warm and they can just keep doing more work for longer periods of time. So he says it's going to allow them to fill more potholes, and fill them
quickly. Should increase efficiency, make the roads better before they have to be done.
And he's used them in his previous places of employment and was very surprised we didn't have one here given the distance, between where we go to get asphalt and the roads that we have.
So again, what we do we are doing investment in this and increasing anything at all is really,
the nice
thing, fairly deeply thought out and justified.
One nice thing in this budget is, we know there's, it's $50,000 in this budget that's more for roads. But we were able to offset that almost completely by a reduction in the general drainage line. That's a line we've been using for the past couple of years to hire an environmental engineer to help us with our MS4 permitting, the municipal stormwater regulations that we have to meet. So we've done a lot of the work, and we also went out to bid, and after getting four proposals, you know, one of the companies we really liked said, look, I'll do a lot of work up front, and then you'll be able to reduce your costs in the long run. So that is a benefit of going out to bid and really getting a better price. And you see the reduction in there, which is almost enough to cover the cost of the increased paving.
And electricity is, again, virtual net metering to some extent. And then heating oil and gas, we've been lucky with. Hopefully that trend continues.
So we'll have a better idea after the engineering firm works with.
Yeah.
And back on the road.
There are some more things to be done. We've mapped all our outfalls, they call them, in town. What we have to do now is we have to map all of our catch basins. We have to establish, link them to GIS, our GIS program. And we also have to purchase a software system that will allow the public works director's staff to follow catch basin cleaners that come in and work for us and document the condition of the catch basin, document how full it was, what was the capacity before it was pumped, after it was pumped, notify, record any funny smells in there or possible illicit connections. So that's the stuff that we have to do, and we have to actually document as well how often these things are pumped. So that's and also what we have to do is the environmental engineer is going to come in after rain events and test the catch basins and the outfalls and see if they exceed any of the levels that are set by the state. It's our next phase.
But thank you, by the way, for working so closely with that company to make sure those costs came down. We're originally looking like $135,000 or something, and that keeps creeping down and down and down. Anything else in public works? Tree warden we talked about. Solid waste disposal. That is that's a big issue, this budget. We have been looking for the last year and a half at how the transfer station functioned. We looked at how it was being used. We looked at how the haulers, when the haulers dropped off waste, when they took it out. We put a traffic strip down to look at for, about three weeks. We had it down to look at actual road flow on in the transfer station. We really wanted to understand what's going on there, because we started talking about it, and then we talked to Waste City Carding to try and understand what's going on there, and it became pretty apparent, pretty clear, that a lot of that tire is being used for certain hauling companies to drop it off there and other hauling companies to pick it up. So they're picking up household waste, they're dropping it off there, and other companies are picking up. However, some of the bigger companies were starting to pick up from the residents and just taking it straight to Bridgeport or Norwalk and not even dropping it off here. They weren't even using it as an intermediary. So we started to try and understand the economics of it. We were paying more and more, because what's happening is China no longer takes a lot of our recycling because it's quote unquote dirty. It's not as clean as it used to be. It wasn't just, cardboard and paper and stuff, but now it's got food waste and everything since single stream starting, and it costs keep jacking up. And in fact, next year we're going to have an $85,000 increase on that budget line.
Yeah, we
had locked into a really good basic deal a couple of years ago.
Yeah. So if we've done a lot of analysis, it's kind of a fascinating, place, transfer station. Even though it seems really boring. So what we, in essence, just piggybacking on what Chris said. We know we're open 6 days a week, about roughly 8 hours every day. And so we did some analysis, just compared ourselves to like communities. We realized no one else is open 6 days a week. I think hardly anyone's open 5 days a week. And in addition to that, we started realizing that less of the neighborhood haulers are using the transfer station to deposit their waste.
Significantly this year, there's been a massive drop off.
It started almost 2 years ago with City Carding, and then now Finocchio.
I mean, a massive plummet, as if they found another place to bring it. Maybe they don't, who knows, they're getting better deals or somewhere. But they are really diverting away from us. So we weren't even using it for them.
Yeah, and so really, if you think about the users, you have, I think, couple categories of users. One of those residential haulers who are pit stopping in Weston to drop their stuff off, and we charge them for that. And then it gets carried away by the big hauler, city carting. That's one class. The other class is the folks that are coming in with like their pickups, and they have the, you know, their couches, they have bulky their bulky waste or their big recyclables like the refrigerator, and they're like, I can't leave this outside from my curb, so where am I going to take it? I'll take it to the transfer station. And then you have the third category of user, which is taking their household waste and their bags and their household recyclables, single stream, and they're coming to the transfer station. So we, when it's all said and done, of course we're charging everyone. We're charging the residential haulers based on the weight that they bring in. We're charging the folks that come that buy the stickers to put on their bags to throw those out, and we're also charging the folks that are coming with the bulky. But we're running at an operating loss, and so if you look on the documents in front of you in fiscal year 16-17, the operating loss was about $112,718, and then last fiscal year it was $140,409. This year we've budgeted a loss of $109,023. We're probably end up somewhere around there. We're projecting right now $113,244. And if we do nothing, it'll probably be a $115,142 loss. That does factor in staff salaries. It doesn't factor in staff benefits or CMERS, whether it be CMERS benefits or health insurance. If you did that, it'd be larger. And so the question is, how do we get that down?
Know that it's going up another 85.
Yeah, and that's not next year. It won't go up about 85, but the year after that, it will go up 85, because that this next year we're entering in, starting July 1, is right. The last year of a three-year deal with City Carting. We locked in at a great time, where we weren't paying hardly anything for our recyclables to be taken away, and we were getting a rebate on the recyclables. When that deal is up, we're going to have to pay for our recyclables to be taken away. So the question is, how do we start chipping into this operating loss? And the proposal is twofold. One is to increase the price of bags from $1.50, or stickers, I should say, from $1.50 to $2. We look through our records. We don't have, I think, Rick has been here for how many years? Rick, 15, 16?
We don't have a record
of increase. So he doesn't have a record of an increase. So that's why we propose that. And also the other part would be to reduce the transfer station hours of operation. It would remain the same hours on Saturdays. But in addition to that, it would be open 4 hours on, let's say, a Tuesday and 4 hours on a Thursday. And that's based on when we see use.
That's how we're going to expand that Saturday.
It'll be just regular on Saturdays at this point.
One?
Yeah. No, it'll close at its normal time on Saturdays, because it is open pretty much.
At 1 on Saturdays.
No, it goes beyond 1 on Saturdays. It goes to, I think, at least 2:30. Let me check. I was just on there today.
Well, in any event, it's not going to get any shorter on Saturdays.
Mm-hmm. We did look at other communities.
And we also looked at when people were using it, even when the haulers were using it. Nobody comes in there before 10, barely. It was City Carting who was actually only bringing the schools.
So how do the other towns, I'm curious, charge?
So other towns charge differently. I do have a sheet which summarizes that. Just want to take that and pass it down. We looked at our kind of neighboring towns that are like us.
Nobody uses our model.
And you know, Wilton has a, you know, like us, you can get a permit for free to enter the transfer station, but then you're paying $4.50 per 32 pounds of garbage. Westport.
So are they weighing everybody who comes in?
I believe they are weighing, or else they're eyeballing it and trying to make a determination if that's
you
a
get
32
pretty good at that after a while.
Yeah.
It's like $20 worth of dump trip.
Westport residents can take up to 6 30-pound bags per trip. No limit on trips and no charge. Reading, it's a $25 annual fee to use the station. Seniors pay 10, and then it's 20 cents per pound of garbage.
And usually the bags, like they're saying in other places, are up to 30 pounds, so you can do the
And is that $25 annual fee everybody, or only if you want to use the
we don't know.
Only if you want to enter in.
Only if you want to use it.
buy the stickers, we actually have multiple.
Oh, there's stickers, okay.
Yeah, the stickers go on the car, and they change every fiscal year, and they have the right color.
Trumbull, no charge to residents. Easton, however, uses Trumbull. It's a shared transfer station in multi-towns, three towns use. So Easton pays $6.50 per visit, and you could dump up to 125 at a time. And Monroe pays $6 a visit. In Ridgefield, there's an annual permit fee of $20 if you're going to use the transfer station. It's $5 per carload of garbage. New Canaan, residents purchase an annual permit for $45 a year. Next year, it's going up to $75 a year. Darien, residents pay an annual permit of $120 a year if they do not use garbage service, or $40 if they have garbage service. Fairfield is a $25 permit to use the station, and that also gets them into beaches. Then they pay $6 up to 125 pounds of garbage.
So there's all sorts of permutations and combinations, and if we were to transition any of them, there would be, you know, a large cost, and then staff time and training. We have all the pre-printed stickers and all that.
How many stickers do we usually sell a year?
30,000.
At least, yeah. That's our revenue? Is that our revenue? Yeah, our revenue is about stickers.
60,000.
60,000? 60 grand we get. No.
Right. About that.
Yeah. $60,000.
So, you know, we're proposing a modest increase, and for people who might be financially impacted, we could talk about, you know, vetting them for other social services in that process. But we don't suspect that an extra, let's say you have 4 bags a month, you know, $2 or $4 extra a month. I mean, just trying to carry the cost.
Do we have any idea what level of compliance we get with the stickers?
I talked to Joe Lametta about it when he was here. That was a question I had. And he said that he believed that, you know, people are really honest about putting the stickers on the bags based on his discussions with the folks that work there. Mm-hmm.
So we're trying to balance between keeping it open. I mean, we looked at it and analyzed it, and if we were going to basically true up the cost so that the people who are using it in that fashion would be basically getting rid of that deficit, we'd be looking at like $5 or $6 a bag, and we thought that would be extremely onerous, especially because we're keeping it open and there's not a whole lot of citizen volume going in there. So we thought this kind of hybrid approach of modestly increasing, that's a percent increase, but in terms of, it's, you know, 50 cents on a bag increase, and still providing sort of, we know most people go on Saturday, but then providing 2 other days, you know, where there was key times where people had traditionally been using it based on all of our metrics, that would be the most reasonable path to go. But I mean, we're open to anything, but we just figured, you know, with everything going on, we just can't keep subsidizing things that sort of don't make sense on.
I think, you know, when you look at it probably historically, and those who've been around for a while can probably speak to the fact that it was the go-to place for probably a huge amount of people in town years ago, and it was the landfill. And, you know, when the landfill closed at that location in any town, it's a natural transition to cap it and put the transfer station on top of it, because that's where people were bringing their waste. My guess is that since it closed, the number of people who've elected to purchase curbside pickup has certainly increased. And so what it has become in a way is government, you know, a subsidy in our budget allocated for the operation of the transfer station. Certainly there are some services there which are hard to get elsewhere. Yeah, they have junk luggers now and things of that nature, but it is hard when you have a couch that needs to go, you know, your curbside pickup provider is not going to take it. So it does still definitely serve a purpose. The question is, you know, for going forward, for the community to answer, Board of Selectmen, others, especially with that 85,000 increase looming for fiscal year, you know, 21, is to what extent does it make sense to keep accepting the household waste in terms of your household trash and your household recyclables?
John, when you and I spoke earlier about this, you believe about a third of Weston households use the transfer station regularly?
Since we don't sell permits, it's really hard to determine. Everyone gets a permit in the mail. That's my guess, and maybe it's my guess is based on the survey, if you look at the citizen survey, there's an appreciation level of about 30-35%. So I figure those people are using it. And, you know, everyone who says, I don't care, I'm not interested, just they're not using it.
Yeah.
I could be wrong on that. I don't know.
It's really hard to tell. I mean, you can take, do the average bag that somebody would, number of bags that they have, and do the divisor into the, you know, number of, divided by number of months, divided by number of weeks, divided by our revenues on it. You know, we looked at the cars going through, and, you know, numbers weren't huge on any given day. So
there are big days like Saturday. It's a big day.
I'm just asking a question. With the increase of 50% per sticker, we're still
50 cents
per sticker. We're still running on a deficit, and it's that deficit next year is going to be the year after is going to be 100,000.
Yeah, I think this. It buys the community some time to figure out, you know, willingness to pay for, you know, it'll be back up to 100,000. Yeah. So it's about 115, right? This year it's about 115. We'll get it down to 18 and then it'll be back up to 115.
Right. So we're going to have to revisit this discussion.
And you factor in the wage increases. Rick, this is a special revenue fund. So when we look at this department, it is different from most of the others in that if it sustains an operating loss, it hits kind of a balance, kind of like our general, it mirrors our general fund. Where is this overall, do you think off the top of your head, in terms of like general, where it stands in balance overall?
Where's the balance?
Because it's hit
it. The fund balance?
Yeah.
Well, it has a positive fund balance.
Okay.
That's because, you know, we have, it's an enterprise fund, so credit for investing capital assets.
Okay.
Otherwise, it actually has a negative unrestricted fund balance, which we need to true up at some point.
Okay.
You know, in all disclosure, you know, we use, you know, we bring our stuff to the dump. So what I'm saying is that as a person who purchases the $1.50 bag, you know, personally, you know, as long as the time on Saturday wasn't changing, I know, and I would say it's not me, it's my husband. I don't, like, for us, the difference between $2 or $2.50 and $1.50 would still not force us to, I mean, it's a whole journey for him, still would not force us to get a car in service, you know.
It's open.
So that's my question.
It's open 8 to 2:45 on Saturday. We would not reduce that.
So it is.
I mean, so the issue. I mean, is $2 the right number? And it's just a number we chose. That's up for discussion. And it's certainly not going to keep it. It's not going to help it break even in the next 2 years. It was sort of a transitional price, and the issue is: do we transition or do we? You know. If we're going to do this, do we bite the bullet and say what's it going to cost to keep this, you know, running, you know, to not be a subsidy?
Well, you know, even if you're open, I'm just thinking about this off the top of my head, the bags do produce revenue, the revenue sales. So, you know, if at one point the municipality said, hey, we're not going to provide the service for household waste and household recycling, we're just going to be there for the bulky and the big, you know, the big ticket recycling items, you know, your deficit may even be the same because you wouldn't have the bag prices to offset it, which are a big source of revenue. So that's just, it gives us more time to do all that calculation, I think, this next coming year.
Well, I mean, how do you fill out the number of 150 going to 2? Do you think $2.50
since it's 150 and that one? Trying to work out mathematically, if we're making 60,000 on the bags every year and there's about 1,000 families using it, right, if it's a third, then we'd have to charge a $600 annual fee in order to permit. I mean, that's a huge number.
Yeah.
So I guess what I'm thinking is we should stick with the stickers on the bags.
Right. We did the stickers on the bag and just raised it up.
Right. The question is, do you go to $2 or do you go to $2.50?
And then if somebody, if the hardship for someone, then they can do it for $1.50.
I mean, again, we're not even close to the cost to run it, so we're talking $5 or $6, at least, you know, back a napkin analysis. So
mm-hmm.
It's still a subsidy, it's still a great deal, but the question is, do we want to revisit this next year and then keep giving people sticker shock, or do we want to...
No pun intended? Pun intended.
Pun intended. Or do we want to just, you know, say what, I think 250 would certainly be closer to putting it on, do it like that.
One of the other ways to look at it is how many bags do you think you bring to the transfer station each week on average for your households?
Two?
Three, maybe four.
Okay, so if you do three,
so
especially after the meeting, is the so that's $6 a week at three bags times 52 is 312, and curbside pickup is costing approximately
45 a month or something.
72
a month.
$72.
I don't know. So
let's go with 60.
I'm not gonna get into
60
that.
60 a month. Is that 60 a month? Wow, that's $7.20. It's about half the cost still at $2 a bag.
So this budget is at space $2 a bag.
Yeah, so that's... so.
But I do think it's reasonable.
Yeah, so $2.50 a bag. $2.50 times 3 times 52 is $3.90 compared to the $720. Two times three times 52 is 312.
Two bags a week.
312 is still half the cost. $2. I think three bags is probably. What do you do a week? How much trash do you think that? Three bags.
Four.
Three or four.
Okay, again.
Disgusting.
It's all going to show up the same.
Goes away.
Family average. Family
so let's. How do you feel about the price? Knowing we might have to revisit it. I mean, are you fine with doing it this year and then revisiting it next year?
Yes, I am. I think you wouldn't want to go to a place where you're getting diminishing returns and people stop using it because the...
Well, I agree with Stefan. You don't want to, you know... again, I'm also thinking that we've apparently never raised the price for a sticker.
Wait for your call.
I don't know. Do you remember if there was a raise?
Maybe 10 years ago. It could be.
It was a long time. It was, maybe Margaret knows. It did go up before I was here.
I'm not really an expert, but getting into a very complicated situation. Believe it or not, the garbage man collection business in town has changed over the years. I don't know how many collectors you have now.
City Carding, Ness, and Finocchio are the three big.
Yeah, well, there used to be like five of them.
Yeah.
And it was more of a head.
Yes, they.
I don't go to the dump.
Right, so some people do and some people don't. Well, all we have to decide here is we know this isn't a number to get us to the place where we're going to be. Do we want to do this in one stage or do we want to do it in multiple stages? And that's sort of a policy decision as opposed to an economic. We know we're going to have to come and revisit this when we're looking at a $100,000 deficit again.
I was just going to say this probably is something as soon as the budget's passed, like in July. We have to check in with City Carding and say, hey, it's a year to go. Let's start doing some analyzing. And then you're talking about it in, like, September in detail.
So do you think there's a possibility if we go to two now, we might have to go to three in the future?
I don't. If there's
so a, I don't want to have, like, a load situation where we're not putting enough into it.
I don't know. It's going to, I'm not sure. It comes to a point too where we start pricing ourselves out and people just start going to curbside pickup, which I don't know if so.
Yeah,
so we're talking right now, we're talking it's 150, we're talking two, or what is it?
Two or 250.
I think
maybe, maybe you just settle for the difference and go to 225. I don't know.
225?
It's up to you guys. I don't know.
I don't feel really powerfully about either way. I think it would be fun.
It's a lot of change in somebody's mind.
Yeah,
it
makes it more difficult.
Yeah, because with 250, you give them a five. Or you okay with that?
Yeah.
250?
Okay.
Let's model in 250, which...
I mean, okay.
It will be...
The
help on actually.
Three bags.
What are we?
$300.
Are we 3.2 or 3.1 with that?
Correct.
This is almost going to be break even now.
Yeah.
So it's another
18, 20,000.
20, yeah.
Yeah.
that brings it to 3-2, right?
This will be positive, very positive.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so let's assume 225, 250, so that people can just give a 5 and we don't have to deal with the change.
And if Mike has a problem with it, you can take it up with you guys.
Okay. So that's the issue. I mean, days, we're going to see if it's not enough for citizens, although we have no empirical reason to think that. We can revisit that. Again, we have flexibility there, but we chose the key times. I'm going to have key days, and Saturday, when everybody's there anyway, is going to be exactly the same. So we anticipate little impact to most people, but we'll see. Anything else, Samantha, on this?
I just want to talk a little bit about if somebody says that this is a hardship, that we have a course that they can take, because, you know, there'll be concerns and questions, and we should have,
yeah,
we are raising this adult.
Social services always addresses people in need and finds a way to make sure that there's no hardship.
So in social services, that's not something I provide at this time, it's a discount on transfer station, but in order to qualify for social services, they need to disclose all of their financial information. So in order for a person to get that discount, they would have to be willing to disclose all of their taxes and bank statements, income and assets.
Okay.
So, I mean, if they qualify, they'll qualify for other things.
Right.
But it would be useful for them to be there anyway. I do think the transfer station is used by people in town as a more economical approach to getting rid of their garbage, because it's less expensive. So
okay.
Yeah, they're still saving half the price over hauling.
Right.
Do we need to vote or create some sort of mechanism to give social services the ability to cut that in those circumstances?
Yes, I think you probably would need to do that, just for official on the record to establish a rate. So
can we put that on the agenda for next time?
Yeah, there's a couple of things. One is, I don't think you have a whole lot of data in making this decision without any information. Secondly, if you raise the price, you may cause people to
price elasticity,
throw the trash on the side of the road, and thereby increase the cost of DPW to pick it up. So I really think you might want to study this more before you make a decision.
Thank you. I guess there is always the risk that people will start throwing trash on the road.
Yes, yeah, and diminishing returns.
And diminishing returns.
Have to watch that. But back to my question, should we have on the agenda for next time or time after that a mechanism for social services to offer stickers at a reduced price?
I do think so, yes.
Okay.
I think there has to be some vote authorizing a sale at a lesser price.
Before there was some informal process where there were some discounts being given without a formal policy, and it wasn't clear and it wasn't happening at all sites. So yes, I think creating, codifying that down, as long as it's not going to create some kind of procedural, I mean, I assume, you know, you already, the people who you have who need it should be getting it.
If they qualify for that, then they qualify for their services.
Right, so use the same criteria.
If they're not willing to talk about what their finances are, and, you know, that's the prerogative. But
true.
I don't know if you have something in place for seniors, some fixed incomes that may not quite be financial need, or is that just...
There's nothing officially there now. So again, you could provide us with recommendations of your thoughts. You know, seniors with fixed income, you know, there's different versions of it, right?
Right.
So
one of the,
again, if they're being vetted through you, we know they need it.
I think it's one of those things too, when you're younger and you have a family, you do have more costs associated with trash, and when you're retired and on a fixed income, logic is you're going to just pay less for trash automatically, having a smaller household. Not the case in every situation, but so there's something to be said for that. So at this point, maybe we could come back to this, perhaps, or what's your pleasure?
I mean, we Well, the question is, would we not have a discount, and what would the discount price be if we set it at $2 versus if we set it at $2.50 versus now? So right now, we don't have the ability to necessarily do that as it is, right?
No, it hasn't.
Right, so.
And I haven't had it.
I don't know if that is a process that we disentangle from the budget process.
Yeah, I think so. That's, I'm not suggesting we hold up the budget for two sessions. I'm suggesting we deal with the abatement, essentially.
So we're in general, we'll get feedback too, probably pretty immediately about the price. And then we'll make sure that the processes and procedures in place to make sure that if this creates a hardship on anybody, that we help mitigate that through our usual channels. Luckily, we have a very good vetting process. So, okay. We'll just make that note that we'll change it. Section 22 is Westport Weston Health District, another one of those things. I will parenthetically note that we are trying to have Dr. Mark Cooper reach out to other communities to see if they would like to join us in our health district.
That's exactly what I was going to ask, is can we...
I saw your notes. No. I'm going to briefly, because I know we're kind of getting down the weeds a lot of stuff. There was actually an event where there was a sort of statewide meeting scheduled, led out of sort of the director of Bridgeport's health district, to come and bring everybody in to talk about regionalization of health districts, sort of out of nowhere. And luckily, at that point, it was actually scheduled during our WestCog meeting, so everybody around here was like, we can't go. Mm-hmm. But if that thing's going to be driven where we're going to be part of the Bridgeport Health District, where they have no subjects and they have obviously very different sort of health concerns in general, in terms of risks and otherwise, bless you, we probably felt we should take the lead in that. So we did talk to Jim Markby, who's the first selectman in Westport, who shares the health district with us, with Mark Cooper. We did say, can you start reaching out to towns in the area, bring them in, explain the benefit of our district, how it works perfectly and seamlessly, explain, look into maybe some of the potential price and other efficiencies that we could have by doing that. So that is something we are looking at.
Right.
This has been a successful regionalization effort, and if we can bring more people in to save it from being mega structures, but more regional structures where towns that kind of fit in with it. I mean, they don't do any wells in Bridgeport. Yeah. Right.
Well, could WestCog be a resource here? Because they have a lot of towns without septic around us.
We have been in talks with WestCog too, but again, we thought we'd first reach out to the more proximal towns that are very much like us and see if we can get their buy-in and then sort of grow it out that way.
All right.
As opposed to, because WestCog also includes Stanford and Danbury.
Yeah. And I'm not suggesting that WestCog would be our health district. What I'm suggesting is, does WestCog have a clearinghouse of towns that are looking to regionalize on a certain issue?
Well, literally every meeting we're talking about something regionalized or another, and again, there's immense hurdles to any of it, but yes and no. To the extent we can, yes, we always do. Westport Water Utility, it needs repairs, some of it minor repairs, but that's what's jacking it up. Any questions? There's a pump house at the transfer station. That's for a few roads that we actually provide water to in town. School town water supply, that's up. There's a lot of maintenance that's needed. We have been actually in discussions about, do we start charging the school for the water? They charge us for stuff we use, like lawn maintenance. Do we charge them stuff for they use, like trash hauling, depositing for water? We didn't think we'd come to a decision on it now, but it's something we wanted to put out there. Probably we assumed it would be 16 grand a year or something we'd be putting back to them if we did.
But to the taxpayer, it would make any difference.
It would not make one iota difference. It would just be more transparent budgeting, that's all.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, we don't need to deal with that. It's just something we should keep in mind. yes, we all would. Human services. it's coming down a little because Allison's going to because of her schedule, going to be working a little less than before, which is great that you can get the same amount done very efficiently. We appreciate it. Meals on Wheels is going down, not because we don't like it. We love it. It's just trend. They're not using it that much, so we're not going to fund it. If for some reason we get a surge in it, we will obviously reallocate it. And obviously we have no intention to have people not be have to, you know, services they need, but they're not using it. Why are we budgeting it? We're not. Very clean, tight budget. Thank you. Youth Services. Up a little. We finally have hired a new Youth Service Director. Hi, Laura. things are going well. Immense amount of progress in terms of programming and communications and collaborations with the schools, which is nice to see. Not a whole lot of change. The change that is in there is because we now have staff in there, right, Jonathan?
Yeah, we've been without staff for about
it. So that was a fairly significant savings running a department without staff, but that only lasts for so long.
Of note is just the extraordinary amount of fund revenue that this department raises through their WOW after school program, which is just awesome because it allows only $26,140 of expenses to the general fund.
And briefly, I will throw out there that allows us to fund a GRP, which allows us to take 12 kids in town, and we're using every slot so far, who are in trouble and are on a trajectory to end up in the criminal justice system, and diverting them out of it through counseling and through community service and other sort of supervised redirectory techniques. We have used it extensively already, real cases, much better than having them have criminal records at this point. So far it's exceedingly successful, but that's being run out of Youth Services with collaborations, wonderful collaboration with the police department and the schools, and it seems to be working, I think, fairly seamlessly, right? So thank you, Laura, for coming in and being everything we hoped and imagined you would be. And delivering a nice tight budget too. Any questions here?
No.
Okay, great. Senior services. We want to invest more in it, but this was a horrible budget year for a lot of reasons, so we couldn't do the investment we want. We do intend, as time goes on, to do more investment in terms of staff hours. We did work out a negotiating deal with the Friends of the Senior Center, where they are no longer a fundraising operation that they had been in the past with the Alden Sherman Car Show and other mechanisms like that. So they asked the town if we would take up some slack in sort of providing funding from senior services.
They wanted us to fund $6,000 because that's what they've been giving on almost an annual basis to fund programs, enhanced programming. And so we negotiated with them and said, well, what if, you know, next year you do three and we'll do three.
Jonathan went head-to-head with Woody. It was an amazing thing to watch, but it ended up with a very fair and equitable solution. I'm thrilled that they're going to continue to help, and we're going to continue to help, and we'll continue to revisit that again.
So that's why we see the increase, yeah.
Yeah, that's why we see the increase there, but it's for very important programming, and I'm happy to do it. Hopefully we can get the staff hour increases there, but Allison, through social services, will be spending some time in the senior center, is my understanding, which is gonna provide some needed support in the building that they've been asking for a while. Public library, gate numbers are astronomical, usage is astronomical. You've been running a great ship, thank you. We do underinvest significantly in books and materials. We had talked about this last year, and we talked about a multi-year plan. that multi-year plan is going to be stretched out a little farther. So they had been budgeted for 65. They wanted to go up to 75. We brought it down to 70. I apologize. I know it's really important. We're just going to have to stretch out that plan. But again, it's hard when we're talking about service reductions to extreme extents in some areas and staff impacts to, you know, expand other areas too much. But we are committed to getting you back up to par, and both in terms of materials and hopefully in square footage. We'll get there. But again, the library is one of our crown jewels of town, so we're happy to invest in it. Any questions here?
No.
Thank you, Karen, Amy, and everybody who works there. Parks and Rec, ongoing discussion, the main one we've had is, most of their programs are cash positive, or break even, or make money. There are two of them that do not. One of them is the 4th of July celebration, but they're basically redoubling their efforts to sort of find sponsors. The other one is the pond. Pond is always coming up. We did, this year, propose a very modest family fee, a one-time for usage all summer of $25. In the past, they charged $50 like 5, 6, 7 years ago, so inflation has actually outpaced that. And they saw very limited usage. When they took the fees away, there was much more usage. But we are looking at a $30,000 at least, and that's not even factoring in sort of full staff allocation, if you're talking about senior staff focusing on managing this. And then every number of years, probably in like 3 years, a $100,000 rebuild, resurfacing that pond. So that it's an expense, it's an amenity, and we don't want to curtail amenities, but we did think that we should ask the users to have some skin in the game, because again, sort of the philosophy here is to true up the areas that are being subsidized. Again, where needed, that will help them with subsidies, but for people who can afford it, you know, we thought if we, especially if we implement it online, you know, I think the problem with people getting passes is having to physically come and get them. If we find an online way to go ahead and do it, we thought $25 for the entire season would not be particularly onerous, mm-hmm. and would give us a true indication of people's actual desire to use it. Because what happens now is they say, oh, we give out 900 passes. That you could just get one and you never use it, right? So we really wanted to understand who's actually using it. We do have gate numbers. Some days we get up to like 100 people. Some days it's much, much less. We don't want to take that away, but we certainly want to transition it to either having it fee-based. And I would also like to encourage Parks and Rec or whoever are very passionate users of the pond to create sort of a Friends of the Pond, like
there
we have.
There is a Friends of the Pond, but they don't fundraise. They just do different, right? They just do the different events.
So let's have them fundraise too, if possible, just because.
Like Pirates Day or whatever.
They have big turnouts from where I understand, yeah. And I think Parks and Rec provided some kind of food, and there's a lot of.
No, it's great. It's just really, it's again, when we're looking at budgets like this and stuff, we can't control.
Like a little makeshift book thing, books where people could.
Library, sharing library.
Yeah,
just one little shot too. It would be nice. I would love to see those pop up all over town over time. They're the greatest thing ever. You take a book, you leave a book, mm-hmm. that type of thing.
I think also this is an opportunity right now because the fees last year went up for the beaches, for the Westport Beach, and people were very upset about that. So maybe if they see that, you know, they have to take a stakeholder in the pond, they understand.
And help us, you know, invest in it. We've got to put $100,000 in. We're going to say, well, now they've got skin in the game. We know how many users are. You know, again, it's an amenity we want. And if it ends up dropping off again, we'll revisit it. But I assume that there's enough passion for it now. And $25 for an entire summer is cheaper than a single movie ticket nowadays.
Yeah.
So, you know, I know.
That would be $25 per family or per individual?
Per family.
Family price.
And we have a drop-in price. Mm-hmm. Family pass, right?
$25 per family pass. They should charge $50 for a family pass.
Yeah, in 2010.
Yeah.
That's the last time I tried it.
Yeah. So we'll see. It might drop. Yeah, you know, we'll see. Any other questions on that? Rec?
Parks and fields.
It's all part of the same thing. We should be expecting some kind of somewhat of an increase. We don't know the true effect of taking over the middle school sort of after school sports programs yet, do we?
What about it?
Do we know the true effect of that yet?
They're all cash flow.
They're all cash. I know, but in terms of enhanced cash flow. We did, because of that, we did actually. We have an enterprise fund. We did actually bump it up. We were taking 30,000 out of it. Trend looked like that thing was continuing to build up. Department request was 35,000. We bumped that up to 37.55, which just means that fund keeps replenishing. If we see that we're doing a drawdown, which doesn't look like we'll do with these numbers based on trend, right, Rick? We're okay with it. That 37.5 drawdown from that should keep it still very much cash flow positive, and everything, you guys run fantastic programs, and everything they're doing is cash flow positive, which is, you know, wonderful, except for those two things I pointed out. Parks and Fields, that's Board of Ed. Like I said, if anybody was at the, we were all there. They have made a decision to handle all their field maintenance on overtime. They are passing that cost along to us. I had asked them to please revisit hiring someone part-time to do it. Apparently they did it 8 years ago. Maybe they're going to be willing to do it again now. There are some fields, in my opinion, that could be done, done during normal work hours, particularly Revson Field and the field outside the admin building are not near any schools. The argument they had provided at that meeting was, well, if we take them off of whatever they're doing to do that, then they're not going to be able to do that. I don't understand the scheduling. I just had asked them, please kindly, to revisit hiring someone part-time and see if that was fiscally reasonable thing to do. You know, there had been discussions in the past of us taking over that function. We'd have the same problems in that situation. And then we'd also have to manage around where they already have crews and otherwise. So that's where that increase is coming from. Hopefully, this will be the only year of that, but I can't guarantee anything. Middle school pool, we did a lot of work last year, so we don't have a whole lot this year. So it's down, which is nice. Debt service, as I mentioned before, any questions on any of that stuff?
No.
Debt service is down, partially because we did a refunding, saved $260,000. Thank you, Rick. That was an amazing effort. I mean, free money, basically, entirely.
Yeah, I don't deserve all the credit.
No, but you took lead. It's great. Talk about revenue now, which is at the beginning of the book.
At the beginning of the book.
The only reason that we can't do much about it is that's really a Board of Finance decision affecting revenue levels. Basically, they get to set the collection rates and stuff like that. We have it in here for information purposes, but even if we gave a recommendation, they don't have to listen to it just like everything else. But so let's talk about revenue.
Okay. So here's my question. In the tax collection, the last line of the tax collection on the revenue side says uncollected taxes. Our variance is we are taking in $928,000 less taxes, fewer taxes.
Yeah.
Why is that such a big difference from this year?
It wasn't, we didn't make a, we maintained, we use the same formula. We're using the same formula for this budget that we used last budget and the year before. The only difference is some of the variables in that formula change, and they're not variables that are subjective. So for example, we go through and we say, okay, look, first one is what's gonna be the tax collection rate? It's been 98, so we said, okay, let's just leave it at 98 and see what happens. Then the other thing is other variables that get included into the formula that spits out that 928,368 are the abatement numbers, the deferrals, the freezes, and things of that nature. So it's the, yes, but we're saying in each of these 2 years that we're not going to collect 2% of taxes. And that's 2% of the total amount to be collected.
Okay.
But the total is going up over the 2 years. So the 2% is naturally going to be higher. So for example, the number that we want to collect, the net, is, or the total revenue at the very bottom of the page, right? Rick, interrupt me if this isn't going to work mathematically. But at the bottom is 74,235,938. That's larger than the number we budgeted the year before,
so
at 71,246.
Right. It's math, but it does raise an interesting point that do we really believe that we're going to take in $81,000 less this year in tax collections? Or is it a mathematical artifact?
That amount would be the highest over the last 5 years. I went back and looked at the last 5 years. I'm just going to round to the nearest thousand. 856,000 was actual uncollected at the end of the year. Then we had a good year, 664,000. then we went back up to 850, 812, and then last year we had another very good year, 664,000. So, I mean, we were running in, you know, the 800,000s, which after abatements and senior abatements and so forth, it's about 98.8%.
Yeah, so we can.
So these years we were 660, we were a little over 99%, 99.1 or so.
So we do great. So let me just circle this back to the comments I made at the beginning of the meeting.
Yes.
Part of the thing is, do we want to leave some padding in there because we still don't know what's coming down from the governor?
Right.
And we don't know what, if any form, any teacher pension pushback is going to take. We saw that the CMERS just came up. They're talking about this bill taking all of our car tax, which put $2-3 million, and eliminating that and instead charging some kind of 1% statewide, and that money being redistributed somewhere else, and I can assume we're going to get a smaller share of that. We don't know all the impacts of all that, so this is one of those areas that we looked at. We said, yeah, it doesn't make as much sense as it could, but do we leave that sort of lack of clarity on that specific number in there as part of sort of a buffer against what might come down? So, I mean,
you know, there are two lines here in this revenue section that one of them is the one you identified. The other is the state aid dash education. We have consistently, over the past 2 or 3 years, I guess, not budgeted the ECS money.
Because they keep trying to take it away.
and so we zeroed it out this year, and we've gotten 117,622 so far. We get the rest, hopefully, and we'll be up to about
263,000.
Yeah. So next year you could say, all right, well, we're going to, I think a lot of it has to do with the governor's budget that's going to come out in like 2 weeks.
Which we will know before we submit the final budget.
And that will say, hey, how much is Weston going to get for ECS? It'll also say, hey, how much is Weston going to contribute for teacher pensions? So maybe it gets, you know, should get revisited then for sure by the Board of Finance.
But those are great questions.
If you take that number, by the way, at the bottom of that column that we're looking at, the 74,235.
Yeah.
And 938, and you multiply it times 0.02, it's 1,484,000. So we take that 1,484, then we back off, right, Rick, the abatements, the deferrals, the freeze, and the abatements to the volunteers.
1,484 should include
all of those.
Yeah, it
should.
Yep. So
you're getting very accounting.
Yeah. Which we know based on trends, we're gonna incur those negative revenues, those costs, if you will, right? So what it leaves behind is the 928,368, which is out of that number at the way on the bottom, the 74,235, is actually 0.0125. So it's
right, which makes sense. Yeah. Because the abatements and so forth are,
yep,
0.075.
Yep.
So there's your 2% for the 98%
collection. And you know those abatements. So if we got 2%, but it's 2% including all those abatements, the deferral, the freeze, for the seniors, and the abatement for EMS and fire. So your wiggle room really is 928 that you won't collect out of a budget of 71,607,000.
Yeah, several years ago, I remember when the assumed collection rate we were budgeting was 97.6, but we've been able to raise that because abatements, deferrals and so forth have actually slightly decreased over time. Of course, the budget has gone up, so that's become a lesser percentage. Mm-hmm. So we've moved it up to 98 over the years. Could we move it a little more? Yeah, maybe.
But we don't know, because we don't know the impacts of SALT, yeah, and we don't know other impacts that are coming down. So again,
if we had to guess, probably say you can move it up a little bit, but it's probably going to be the Board of Finance.
Remember, every $25,000 is one penny on the mill. So whatever we're doing here is not
going to move the needle in the big $2.5 million scheme of things. So we can do that. It, you know, we tend to leave that to Board of Finance because they kind of like to get into that space. They'll set it anyway, and they'll set those numbers. So we did the best we can in ballparking it. And, you know, as we tend to be really conservative with these parts of the budget, which is partially why we keep accruing the reserve fund. But now we have that to build with, and we don't have to bond. And they can revisit it any way they want. So I have a procedural question. Motion. Do we refer a specific? I mean, do you have any changes you want to make?
You know, no. I had a few questions that I wanted answered before we voted, but as I listened to this budget, I feel very comfortable with it, frankly. I have a couple of comments. One is that I piggyback on what I just said. I don't think you cut this budget. I was going to ask you to do what Brian
did
last year.
We do. Oh, okay, let me take a step back.
What do you do if you cut it all the way back to zero?
We have that. Okay, we did that exercise, and as we used the metaphor last year of cutting the bone, we get into the bone here, but now we're cutting through the bone. We have a list of cutting through the bone for you that we're not going to talk about publicly because it will affect it. We tried to be fair about it. We said, look, if we're going to cut, we're going to see what the hit is that every department would take fairly. And it is vicious, and we don't want to go there because, again, it's not going to affect the level of change that we could in the scale of things. But Jonathan has it, Rick modeled the financial impacts. You can speak to them directly. It's just not something, because we can't do it in an executive session, so we just have to do it out here. We'd say, oh, well, this department, we do this. Nobody wants to hear that or see that. I don't think we have to go there now. You know, if we get a 30% pushback from the pensions again, you know, we have no choice and it's really doomsday scenario, then we go there, but that's exercise has done, and I appreciate bringing up on.
I agree. Okay. I don't feel I need to see it before we vote. And I think that if we were to cut anything here, what we would need to do is find some way to regionalize certain services. Nothing insane like the legislature suggested, but some of these more ancillary services. And some of these things that we've already talked about, like the health district, can we further regionalize that?
Discussions are going on. Yeah.
All right, and I guess here's my question, as our representative at Westcog, which is supposed to be the organization that finds these synergies and these efficiencies. What is the first step in order to successfully regionalize the service? Are they the clearinghouse for this sort of thing? How do we do it?
Yes and no. So the irony of it is they were created to be the clearinghouse of that sort of thing, and the state keeps cutting their budget. So they say, you need to do this, this is important. Everybody says, we need to do this, this is important. And then they say, we're going to cut the budget of the organization that's supposed to be shepherding it through. There is a task force that discusses regionalization. Right now we're looking at things like stop-loss insurance creating a pool. That would be a huge savings. Individual towns are looking at all sorts of different departments, and I don't want to go through them because we've already been getting emails about, oh my God, you're regionalizing the transfer. No, but I mean, you talk about anything. So I can tell you every single area that is ongoing, always talks about dispatch, things like that, is ongoing, talks about police that I don't think are going anywhere because we have the police station right here. But there's multiple towns that are saying, hey, why don't we get together and do this? And I can't just say, hey, no, absolutely not. I say, you know, we're probably not going to do that, but go ahead with the exercise, present it with the numbers. So these discussions go. The impediment to that is something called MIRA, Municipal Employees Relations Act. Right now, you cannot, and they actually are proposals to change that in current bills in there, and I'll dig them up and I'll have Jonathan or Rick send them to you. There are bills that say, hey, let's reopen how those laws work. Because right now they say, you cannot give work from a bargaining unit in town to another bargaining unit, and another bargaining unit will be another town, right? So if I wanted to regionalize, you know, chair polishing with Wilton, I could not give the work of the polishing chair if we had somebody here to another town. So what those laws are doing are saying you are exempt from that part of it until after the bargaining unit gets reformed by the kind of dual, and I'm oversimplifying, by the combined structure. We don't even know where that is or where that's going to go. So that is really, and we've been looking at this for years. We looked at it with tax assessor when there was an opening. Because what you want to do is when there's an opening, because then you're not impacting people. We talked to Westport, we looked at it, we ended up like potentially, if we could possibly do it, saving like $5,000 or $6,000, but everybody from here would have to go to Westport for everything. And then that was a potential savings. So literally, anytime anything comes up, and we're in like five different discussions with different people about different stuff, with all our neighboring towns, it's going to be hard till there's some systemic change up in Hartford. Because, and again, you know, you understand why it's like that, but then stop telling us we need to regionalize, and then, you know, there's all this pushback. It's a complicated situation. So
I also think, just to add to that, once you get into the conversation and you start looking at numbers, it's not the panacea that everyone thinks it is. No. In terms of savings.
There's one person doing everything. It's just can't do it much less.
In communities of our size, you know, you can't have one person doing both jobs. You know, I'm just going to pick a number, right? Position, tax collector. Well, you can't have one tax collector doing tax collection in two communities because, you know, number one, if they get sick, I mean, then both communities are just, you know, royally, like, just in a jam. So it, for so many things, it doesn't make sense. I think it makes sense when you're in smaller communities. I worked in a smaller community. You know, you in a smaller community of like 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, you're not going to be able to attract someone given your salary of what you pay to be an assessor or whatever. So then you say, all right, let's, you know, two towns, neighboring towns can come together and let's put together a really good salary and hire someone, because who wants to work like 20 hours a week somewhere, right? If you can go work somewhere 40. So I think just generally those are some of the difficulties. There might be some areas, you know, where you can, where it works, but again, there's that obstacle of, you know, bargaining over the impact.
And then if it makes sense, and then one party is usually going to have it be put out by the citizens, yeah. Right? But that said, it is a constant discussion, and I know it's a constant discussion amongst us, and it always, it's a nice solution because nobody gets hurt, but we haven't been able to financially make it. The health district is a perfect example. And if we get more towns to join in on that, our costs go down. That's where it can possibly work. There are other things like that, I don't want to specifically say what they are, that might potentially work like that. And we do constantly discuss it, but again, nothing has really, for example, the transfer station, you know, we're in talks with people, you know, about consolidating here, doing, maybe we do consumers here and hauling in another town, right? And we just shift our haulers to there, and they have, but you know, first of all, in order to do it, you got to spend $25,000 to do stuff, right? So then you're putting the money in, then you got to amortize out that expense to potential savings, and you end up with, you know, $5,000 or $10,000 and a lot of inconvenience in the end. But I'll still continue to pursue it because we do have 169 or whatever distinct towns that are doing basically the same thing.
My other kind of overarching question is this, and I've heard debates here and with the Board of Finance about how big our general fund needs to be in order to preserve AAA funding. And there's clearly some margin there. Okay. We've clearly got more than we need. And what is the impact?
Do you pass that down on?
What is the impact? Should we lose our AAA and need to borrow?
Better question. So the first one, we're talking 12% or 13% after talking bond agency ratings. But it's really.
So which is like 2 or 3 million, right? If I did the math in my head correctly.
It's a little bit more than that. Let's just use 13 million.
It's not. Yeah.
Probably closer to 4 million.
So that would again. So, but they also, we talked to them. And they say, well, looking at is quote unquote your citizens' ability to pay. Mm-hmm. So in that, we could be at like 1% and it'd still be fine.
We do have...
But they don't want to see that, obviously.
You know, we have about $3.6 million of expenditures coming up between the radio telecommunications project, which could be a little lower, could be a little higher, we're not sure. That was just our best guess, you know, a couple months ago. And then we have, included in that $3.6 million, the EMS project, the police, which we've planned for years and saved up money, you know, the EMS expansion slash roof project, and then the police renovation project.
But I think we've calculated that in our $3+ million figure, right?
That's 3.6 off of what we...
Right, Yeah, so if we're using close to the number Jonathan's talking about, that would bring us down a little over 13%, maybe 14%.
Right, so we're kind of on the borderline of that.
I do think, though, yes, so if we knew there was nothing else around the corner, then I would say, hey, consider taking a million more. I think we have to be on the lookout for the teacher pension cost shift, because with the mill rate increase being so high as it is right now, I know it, you know, it's high, especially given the fact that there's reval and the impact it's going to have on those lower segments of the real estate market, so to speak. If there is a considerable cost impact to the town, then I think you would want to use the fund balance to either pay for it all the first year or pay for a portion of it so you could smooth it out over 2 years. Because I don't know.
There's no magic percentage. I mean, we tried to press our FA on this, and there's a Moody's scorecard out there that they use all these different metrics to come up with a rating, and the fund balance is like, the fund balance itself is like maybe 5 or 10% of the entire rating, and the change in fund balance over time is another 5 or 10%.
Yeah, you're drawing it down precipitously.
I do think we're also
going to have other metrics too.
I do think we're also going to have to talk about using some of it to catch up on roads.
So, and I bring this up for a number of reasons. Obviously, two of them are that
and the board
rate is going to be bumping up to 32. Hopefully,
and that's
a major jump up, and it's going to be bad optically to a number of people.
I do think also the Board of Ed security cost of $400,000.
$300,000 to $400,000.
Maybe lumped together in the mind of the Board of Finance with the radio telecommunications project and the EMS fire project. EMS PD project. And say, let's throw that all in.
But we do have some sort of margin, and it's not clear what that margin is. We can probably exceed the margin we talked about without a problem. So again, my issue is that we're going to have a mill rate jump. It's going to be optically not that great. And secondly, we had last year the governor kind of made a grab for that money. And the worst thing that could happen is that we save and save and save, and then the legislature takes it from us, and we get nothing for it. So I don't expect the Board of Selectmen to say, okay, we're going to cut this budget by a million and take it out of the general fund. But I just kind of want to get it out on the table and have the discussion.
I would recommend encumbering it, though, in any event, for the things that we know are coming down the line.
Those big ticket capital items that come around every so many years, like the $600,000 fire truck and the spikes in the capital budget are the perfect time to use it. Because you can say, all right, we're going to cover the, let's say you're spending $1 million a year in the capital budget, but 1 year it's 1.5. Well, that's a perfect time to use it, because next year it drops to $1 million. You're not going to have the pain of not being able to utilize it again the next year. So we did ask for, a 3-year capital budget. And we set up our 3-year capital budget, so that's pretty steady. It's like a 2%, let's say a 3% increase. After this year, for the next 2 years, the Board of Eds does have to spike this year. So maybe this is the opportune time to use it, because the next 2 years
and
it'll drop.
And that discussion always will come up in the Board of Finance. So they will have that. And again, if it's a reasonable thing, I mean, last time they wanted to do it just to lower the mill rate when we're already at 1.69.
Yeah.
I didn't think it was a good idea, mainly because it spikes it back to next year. Mm-hmm. So you're just creating a hole, but there are issues you point out. I would like to sit down and figure out all those large capital expenses we have, figure out how we could potentially encumber them for specific reasons that you cited, and it is more than just that. Mm-hmm. Negotiations reasons too. And then see what's left and then see where it sits. We did, when we got the new bond refunding Moody's came in or whoever it was, and we were talking to them, we were very transparent about the expected expenditures, and they were comfortable. We did sort of lay out all these other things we had. The question is, how do we technically start encumbering it before we have fixed prices? The telecommunications discussions, I don't think, are at the point as of yet where we can say this is what it's going to cost. It's sort of fluctuating with $500,000, and I don't think we want to necessarily tie that up without knowing that number for sure, but that should be done I would guess in the next 3 to 6 months. Now we could talk about, you know, let's ask for the appropriation for that, and even if we don't get to do it this year, how many years do we have once we do the appropriation to potentially spend it?
For which prop, what type of prop?
Well, let's say we said communication, we knew the ballpark, but it would be another couple of years.
For that, unlimited.
So.
Yeah, as long as it's not bonded, okay. Yeah, you're right.
So. But I, your points are very valid, so I don't disagree. But keep in mind that some of the people with the 30%+ mill rate increase, some people are going to be paying even less tax than they did last year, but they're on the lower value.
And I would also be interested, and I don't know if we have the historical data, but I know that I see that from in the reval year, from the last reval that we did, where it went down. The change in the ground list was nearly 12.5%. The mill rate did go up 5%. I mean, it did go up from 23 to 28.
What fiscal year was it?
And that was from 2012 to 2013.
Yeah, and I actually spoke to Dick Pachinski and asked 12, them, what did you guys do about that? They said nothing.
Yes, I asked him too.
If you looked at the budget increases, you don't see anything out of it.
And when you look at the, and then the big jump, we're still adjusting to the 32% increase from 2003. In the grand list, and yeah. This is still that adjustment.
Yeah, rebounds make it complicated.
So I was interested in, you know, what did they do? They had, and that was, you know, the economy was not doing well at that time, and the mill rate changed. But I have a question related. If all things, you know, stay the same, no other numbers change, and it's $433,000 increase in our budget this year, what is that? Chris, you mentioned something. You said like $25,000 represents a penny.
Do you want to know what how many mills that is?
No.
$25,000 is roughly a penny on every mill, ballparking.
So. You did it like it was very
helpful.
So we're
helpful. Talking like 18 cents. It
was really again, helpful to look at the, when we did the reval, and we said 5.3 homes, 7 homes that are 450,000 to 550 on a 3.5% spending increase would pay $567 more. And we have that scale. I'm just curious, in real dollars, not percentage, not changes, all of those things. In real dollars, what is $433,000 in a change in our budget, the 3.3? What is that actual dollar?
In terms of what someone is paying on their property taxes, an increase?
Yeah, well, just per mill.
Oh, well, so 433 equals how many mills, right? Is that it?
Yeah, divided by 25.
It's actually lowering a little now because the grand list is lower, right. So it's 22,000 plus this. It's 20 mills.
So sorry.
We're getting really, really mad.
I'm getting.
You should be able to answer this one.
Yeah, I just think that it's important to know what a percentage, what that equals.
So what we're looking at right now.
How much is this? How much does this increase?
So that we know that the mill rate will go up 3.27, which is an increase of 2,236,000.
No,
get
factored in
there. So my iPhone doesn't go that.
So if you get 20
big, hold on.
Did I really stop? Should I ask a stuffy question?
You cleared the room.
I'm losing it. I cleared the room.
Yeah, yeah. So it's going to be around 20 to 20 cents. So in other words, of the 30. 2.66.
So I ballparked 18 cents. We're talking 20 cents.
Yeah,
it's 20 cents.
My way was a lot faster.
Okay.
Although less accurate.
20 cents. Okay.
So 20 cents on every mill.
That's the impact of our budget.
That's the impact of our budget, 20 cents.
So back to sort of the original question. What, do we have to vote on a specific number, or can we just vote to recommend moving this budget forward as presented? What did we decide on the transfer station fees for now?
I recall it being 250.
250, so we will have to modify it?
So Rick, you can just include that in your budget. You can include that in your motion.
So we need a motion to refer the budget as presented, with the exception that on the revenue side, well, is it revenue side or it's tied to the special fund for transfer?
You can just say that the price per bag, per sticker is $2.50.
And we'll recrunch those numbers and present.
Yeah. So we'll actually have a meeting tomorrow, right, to set the transfer?
Not unless they just do it tonight.
Okay.
So I move to approve the budget as presented and refer it to the Board of Finance with the revision that the per bag fee would be $2.50.
And a second.
Second.
Any discussion? Thank you for the very vigorous discussion. I thought it was really illuminating. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Oh, wait. Especially thank you. I want to thank all the staff.
Oh, thank
funders.
You, everybody. Just love.
I'd like to thank them.
So, I know I cleared the room. But now
with
the question.
With the wonkiness.
So this calculation is driving me nuts because it's 20. So 20.
20 cents on each
note. Let's figure it out. So that's why I'm asking you.
Right. So $500,000. That's what it is.
Cents
on
the
almost.
Yeah. It's either 10 bucks or 100 bucks, and I can't get the decimal point.
Let's go to the
10 bucks, is my guess.
Probably 10 bucks.
It's got to be 10 bucks.
Because the overall impact, the overall impact to the lowest end households, which include debt 500,000, is about $600. So it's probably 100 bucks, because we're probably 160.
Oh, yeah.
So you're right, it's 100 bucks.
I do want to, while everyone's here,
Yes. But on lower end houses,
I do want to thank everybody who's here in the audience, and especially Rick Darling, who did a magnificent job with his budget.
Thank you.
Very knowledgeable, helpful, and Randy, who also helped put it together.
We think that budget's going to be serious.
I'm going to go
to
7 o'clock.
Get some rest. Thanks for coming.